of this year's EU Regional School Courses series. Today's lecturer is Professor Ryan Elliott from the University of Minnesota. He is in the aerospace engineering department there, and has done all his coursework in aerospace, or with some math degree, I think, thrown in there. His focus area is on alloys and on various aspects of interfaces in
phase transformations.
Yes. So going from one state to another as you change different conditions, temperatures, pressures, alloy compositions, things like that. And so our paths actually first crossed about 12 years ago.
Yeah.
We are both sort of graduates of the same fellowship program in the U.S. to support computational science research. It's sort of like an ACES program, but sort of spread out over a lot of different universities. And so we've been at a number of conferences and annual meetings together. Some of you may have noted and participated last week in a course with a very similar topic, modeling materials. Ryan is one of the participants in that effort as well. If you guys were there, you actually now have a book that's co-authored by him on continuum mechanics and thermodynamics. The presentation today will be sort of a mini summary of that larger program with a slightly different focus and different presentation style. So hope you guys appreciate it and jump into the line.
Great. Thank you, Matt. Before you leave, I'll thank you for the invitation to be here and to get to know the ACES group and Aachen in general. So it's very nice to be here, and thank you all for attending. As Amit said, the listed title here was the modeling and simulation of the terminals, continuum, atomistic, and multiscale techniques. I'm going to move a little bit away from that and give my own flavor. It's a little more of my own research interest. It's about given the subtitle, Stability and Bifurcation Elastic Structures and Materials. And so largely what we'll be doing is looking at techniques for exploring physical models and understanding the equilibrium structure of those things. And applications will range over all of these different sorts of continuum, atomistic, and multiscale types of applications. So I'm going to give you the big picture of the way I think about the science that I do, basically. I'm primarily interested in static types of problems, so equilibrium types of properties and behavior of systems. And in nonlinear cases, then you also have to talk about stability. So it's not really enough in a nonlinear system to know that you have an equilibrium configuration. You want to know, is it stable or not? And I will be interested in highly non-linear systems, which typically means then you have non-uniqueness of equilibrium configurations or solutions. And so here's the typical golf ball on a golf course sort of pictures of what I mean by stability within this sort of framework. So places where the slope is zero would be equilibria. So that would include both minima and maxima, and in higher dimensions, saddle points. But then stability is using a local energy minimum criterion, so that valleys or wells like this, where the ball will return to the bottom of the well when perturbed under gravity, say, would be considered a stable equilibrium configuration, whereas a hill like this, where when perturbed, the ball would roll and diverge away from that original equilibrium configuration, would be considered an unstable type of configuration. I'll make my comment here. I forgot to just a minute ago. I'm happy to take questions as we go along. So if something is not clear, I'll try to answer it at a time. And if it's going to be more involved, I'll delay until the end of the session. So typically, the sorts of things I'm going to do is all of the physics of a problem will be built into an energy model or an energy landscape, which is kind of the green landscape here. And then in these cases where we have such highly nonlinear systems, and especially high dimensional systems, it's very difficult to find all of these equilibria in that landscape. And so you need tools in order to probe and explore that landscape in order to understand what that complex physical model really predicts as far as equilibria and stability. And so the tool that I use to explore and understand these sorts of landscapes is what I call a branch modeling and bifurcation approach. And so this is sort of continuation methods where you are able to follow the evolution of an energy landscape, follow the evolution of an equilibrium point as you change a parameter, which might be a loading, the weight that's applied to a structure, or the temperature of a system. And by doing that sort of technique, you're able to map out the set of equilibria and find new equilibria by following these things. And so basically today what I'm going to do, after I give you a lot of examples where I think this sort of framework is useful, is I'll describe what this sort of investigation is, and then go through in relative detail the computational aspects of performing such an investigation of a given physical model. So what is the mathematical background or setup for this type of investigation? So the main ingredients of a branch modeling and bifurcation study, well, you need this energy landscape. So there's going to be some sort of physical model energy. And it's going to be, so I use this capital E, curly E, and it's going to be a function of some generally high-dimensional configuration space, configurational variables, which I'll call X. And so those might be positions or displacements or what other types of things. You might have some sort of polarization vectors or something like this in your physics that describe the configuration from which you can compute an energy. And then there'll be some sort of scalar loading parameter, which describes, as I say, like a parameter model that is a kind of an external applied forcing to the system. So it might be a temperature that you're varying and looking for changes in phase in a material. It might be an applied force to a structure, the load on a bridge, whatever is appropriate for your physics. And we're going to restrict that to a scalar type of measure. Then if you have this sort of setup, then the typical sort of result that you would get is that equilibrium, if you use this in a sort of dynamical Hamiltonian sort of sense, you would get that equilibrium configurations that are static in time, then would typically be described by solutions to this set of equations. So the derivative of or the gradient of this energy with respect to the configuration being equal to zero is going to give you equal the criterion for equilibrium, either stable or unstable. So this equation identifies these points, but it's not enough to determine if it's stable or not. And when we've got this parameter, then this is an underdetermined system. And so with one extra parameter, this equation typically implicitly implies the equilibrium configuration, sorry, that should be X, as a function of the parameter lambda. And so this typically then describes curves through parameter space or configuration space, which describe the evolution or the change in the, say, location of a minimum as you change the parameter. So for instance, if I took this whole green thing and took the loading parameter as an angle at which I inclined the surface, then as I change the angle, the location of the minimum energy would, say in this case, shift to the right. And that curve would, that location versus lambda relationship would be described by, implicitly described by the solution of these equations. Then of course, once you find a solution or multiple solutions or this curve of solutions even to the equilibrium equations, as I say, you want to know if it's stable or not. Is it something that you would physically observe in the dynamical system, or if you put it there and perturbed it, would it diverge away to some other stable equilibrium? And so as I said, we use local energy minimum criterion as a stability criterion. So small perturbations lead to a return to the equilibrium point as being stable. And in this sort of finite dimensional setting, it is sufficient to simply look and see that the second gradient, the Hessian of the energy, is a positive definite tensor or matrix. And so if we evaluate that, this is then the criterion for positive definiteness, or equivalently, we need to say that this stiffness matrix or this Hessian has all positive eigenvalues. And so that would be then evaluated as a stable equilibrium, if that is the case. And if there are negative eigenvalues, it would be unstable. Okay, so that's the framework. Now, what do we mean by doing a branch modeling and bifurcation technique within this sort of framework? Well, so here is an example energy landscape. So the configuration has been reduced down to just a single dimension so that we can plot it to give you the idea. And so at any given value of the loading parameter, you can take a slice through this higher dimensional energy landscape and you get another energy landscape, which might have multiple minima, multiple wells. And in general, this dimension, which is here, not here, would be actually high dimensional, right? So you can't just plot it and look at this, and look for this, the equilibrium points. But then as you change the loading parameter, that energy, that high dimensional energy landscape morphs or evolves and changes to a different sort of landscape. And for instance, you know, this maximum here moves a little bit and to this point, and the relative difference in energy of those two guys gets closer. And we're interested in knowing where all these points are and what their energies are and their stability for a range of the loading parameters. But we don't really want to try to grid up the entire space, evaluate the energy, and identify everything by sort of visualizing the whole thing, because that's just going to be computationally intractable as soon as the dimension of this configuration space becomes more than two or three. So what we'd like to do is actually focus directly on those points in configuration space that we're most interested in, which are the equilibrium points, and find an efficient way, computationally efficient way of finding those points as functions of the loading parameter. And so down here we have what we call a bifurcation diagram, which is just a set of curves in the configuration space that represent the locations of these equilibrium points. So we can see here at high values of this loading parameter, we've got just a single minimum, and it's a minimum, so it's stable. And so in a bifurcation diagram, we would just have a single line at that value of configuration. We use a solid line in this case to indicate that it's a stable equilibrium configuration. And so just by looking at this, we can see at these values of loading, there's only one equilibrium configuration and it's stable. And then we can imagine following the evolution of this point as we lower the loading parameter. And so if we know this point, we could find a point nearby in lambda space and continue that and follow this equilibrium branch or path through this space down to here. At this point, we would recognize that we've reached this sort of inflection point here. The stiffness of the system, the second derivative of the system, would end up with a zero eigenvalue. That's what we would call actually a bifurcation point. And for lower values of the load, we now are at a local maximum. It would be a negative eigenvalue in the stiffness. We recognize that as an unstable equilibrium. And so along the curve, we still plot that there's a solution, but we plot it as dashed to indicate that it's unstable. And then at this special point where we have the transition from a minimum to a maximum, we have this critical point or bifurcation point. And it turns out that from those sorts of bifurcation points, we get another branch of equilibria that emerge. And so that's these little maxima that are here and here, which run back. And if you follow those in the bifurcation diagram, you see that you get this other curve. It's a maximum or unstable here. But then as you reach back to this level of the loading parameter, there's another sort of transition state where it goes from a maximum to a local minimum. And so the equilibrium then is actually identified as stable. And so we see that in this case, there's some symmetry and we get a stable set of equilibria on both in sort of positive values of x and negative values of x in this sort of scenario. And so certainly this set of points, the red and blue points, is a much lower dimensional set of quantities than this whole set of points that map out the entire space. And so we would like, and since in this, as my postulate, I'm mostly interested in these points, we'd like numerical techniques that make it more efficient to compute those points specifically as opposed to looking at the entire space. So let me give you a quick physical interpretation here. This system then you would physically interpret it as at high values of lambda would live in this red equilibrium state with sort of a zero value of configuration. As you lower the loading parameter, it would stay in that configuration and nothing would seem to happen until you reached a value here, this lambda minus, at which point that configuration becomes unstable. And then you would actually expect some sort of dynamic transition to another stable equilibrium structure. So there would be, you know, basically nothing happening as you're changing the loading. And then almost in some sense, suddenly as the loading has changed, there'd be a large deviation of the configuration of the system to one of these two symmetry-related configurations. And so you would see some sort of large signature of that sort of transition in the system. And then for lower values of the loading, it would follow along this blue curve. And then actually you could imagine reversing the process and increasing the load from that point. And you'd start from here, say. And as you increase the load, it's going to follow the blue curve because that's stable until you reach this point, at which point you'd have a dynamic transition to the central red equilibrium configuration. And so in this way, this sort of investigation can actually identify historic type of behavior even in a system that is purely sort of elastic and in some sense conservative. And so you get a sort of history-dependent loading path in some sense. Okay, so that's the broad view about how I generally tend to think about the science problems I'm interested in. And so here's an outline of the overall talk. I've just finished the types of problems, and now I'm going to spend a reasonable amount of time showing you a number of physical problems and examples and scientific questions that I think can be addressed by this sort of viewpoint of modeling physics. Then we'll take a real case study of a very specific branch on bifurcation problem, very simple, one that shows all the details and shows all of these different effects. We'll look at what happens if you perturb your system a bit in a small way from a perfect symmetric system. Then we'll get into the numerics of how you actually numerically compute these bifurcation diagrams for a given system once you have an energy function as something that you can work with. So how do you follow a branch? So how do you compute, say, this red line or the blue line? And then how do you bifurcate from a branch? So as you're following one of these lines, how do you identify these bifurcation points and then characterize the bifurcating paths so that you can follow those bifurcating paths with the same sort of algorithm you were using to follow the red curve. So there's a bunch of numerical and mathematical tools that can be used there. And then at the end, I will summarize it by showing you a specific example of where I've used these tools to study the behavior of solid-to-solid phase transitions in what are known as shape memory alloys, which we'll look at all those details and we'll see how we can understand the behavior of a model that I developed based on the results of a branch-hollow bifurcation type of investigation. Okay, so questions so far? All right, so let's look at a bunch of sort of types of typical problems that show instabilities of this type that have a nonlinearities that lead to multiple equilibrium solutions under varying loading conditions. Okay, so here's a dangerous sort of example. The railroad tracks, nominally their equilibrium condition is straight, but if they sit out in the hot sun, they get heated up, and they like to expand a little bit, right, with thermal expansion. And if it's enough, and the track is designed in the sort of wrong way, you can get a buckling or an instability where the thermal expansion leads to a large deformation of the track, and obviously that's a bad thing that happens. So you want to be able to understand when that would happen so that your design will avoid such a catastrophe. Here's a typical I-beam experiment that you can do in the lab. If you know, it's a nice symmetric I-beam. If you load it with relatively small amounts of load, it just bends in plane. It bends just straight down in the plane of loading of the vertical flange here. But if you load it high enough with enough weight, eventually that becomes unstable and it will buckle left or right somewhat randomly, essentially, and that can be all described by this sort of nonlinear type of energy model that would lead to this prediction of this sort of behavior. But not all instabilities are should be considered bad. You can actually take advantage of these sorts of instabilities if you know about them and can predict them well enough. And so, in fact, sort of an older style keyboard is a nice example where under the key they had a little spring, and as you push the spring down initially, it gives quite a bit of resistance, but then as you get to a certain amount of displacement, the resistance reduces significantly. And that mechanism is controlled simply by an instability in the spring where initially it's deforming as a vertical column, and then at that critical value of load, it actually buckles like an Euler column buckling. And so you get this much larger set of displacements that ends up being a much softer sort of resistance. And so you get this sort of two-phase type of resistance in your keyboard. Many years ago, you guys probably don't remember, but many years ago, these were very common keyboards, and they were quite popular for exactly for that type of reaction that the keys gave. Other sort of structural engineering examples, thin-walled tubes, thin-walled shells are very commonly observed or show this sort of instability behavior. So if you take a thin-walled shell like this, so this is just some sort of silo or tube, and you compress it, initially it's perfectly straight and just has sort of elastic compression, but eventually you get an instability where you can get all sorts of complex buckling patterns or deformation patterns associated with a wide variety of equilibria that are supported by this sort of system. And it's not all engineering and small things. I think you can apply this to the macroscopic geological world. So mountains, at some point in geological history, there was a desert, let's say, and there were tectonic plates that were pushing against each other, and there was an instability, and they deformed and pushed up mountains. And so it would be possible, I think, to try to model the formation of mountains in this sort of way. Here's a slightly smaller scale sort of event that was initially in equilibrium in one space, which was usable like ours, and then there was some sort of geological event that caused this sort of deformation and damage, which is now a static state like this. So these are the sorts of things that I think you can start to understand if you have a good physical model describing the overall system. You can have plates that buckle under various loads. Here's just a ceiling that, due to humidity, has wrinkled. You could presumably model the behavior of that ceiling material with varying humidity level and be able to possibly predict the onset or the creation of these sorts of wrinkles. Now we get into materials, which is more where I think about on a daily basis. So here are just some examples of forming. So I think this was just a mechanical dog bone specimen where you pull it to measure the stress-strain type relationship. And you can see the striations that have formed on the surface here. So that's the indication of dislocations being formed in the material and propagating to the surface of the material. And again, the formation and motion of those dislocations could be viewed as an instability, transition from one equilibrium structure to a significantly different structure. Here's a big piece of steel that was cold rolled to form this shape, and you can see the striations along the surface. Again, that sort of wrinkling of the surface could be viewed as an instability coming away from the previous equilibrium configuration where we had a nice flat surface. Now down in scales even deeper, so here's a micrograph of a nano indentation experiment of a perfect crystal of say, I don't remember what this was exactly, but say nickel. And you can see there's, here's the top surface, so this is sort of cut away then, and here's the indentation from the nano indenter that was left after the experiment. And all these shadowy regions and this line here on the surface are dislocations and dislocation networks that have been formed due to the nano-imitation event. And so again, all of those can be viewed as some sorts of instabilities, the nucleation and growth of those. Here's just more examples of dislocation loops that show up in materials. This is representing an attempt to simulate this sort of indentation experiment where you have, say, a finite element, and at this level it's atomistic, individual atoms, and you're imposing a perfect indenter here, forcing the material to deform, and eventually, initially it's perfectly uniform deformation, but then at some critical value of the indenter depth, these dislocations form and shoot through the material, and those would be these sorts of instabilities that that I think you could look at with these branch hopping bifurcation types of investigations. More materials, so crack propagation formation could be viewed in this way. Here's a really interesting case. This is a crack propagation in a shape memory alloy, and so that's a material that transforms its phase from one crystal structure to another under various conditions. Certainly in some cases, the application of a stress or load can cause the transition. And so here you have this crack propagating, so you've got a very complex stress field at the crack tip. And that complex stress field is actually causing the phase transition to occur in the material, and then that phase transition is propagating out along here. And so these striations are not dislocations in this case, but different phases of the material that are being formed due to the propagation of the crack through here. So all of these things, I think, can be studied in this way. Here, this is meant to represent cavitation in materials. So initially, you've got a nice homogeneous, essentially homogeneous, uniform block of, say, rubber, maybe a latex rubber or something of that type. And it turns out that if you apply the right sorts of loads, either very high compression or very high uniform expansion, you can actually get cavitation inside the material. You can get holes to open up spontaneously in the material. And so this is the end result of basically this thing being subjected to relatively large triaxial loading, where you get this spontaneous formation of these holes. And so up to a certain level of the loading, you just see uniform behavior like this, and then all of a sudden these things sort of pop into existence, and that's another one of these instabilities and transitions. Kinks in composite materials, fiber-reinforced composite materials can be viewed as this. Under certain levels of loads, they're nice straight fibers, and then eventually at a certain level of load, they kink like this, so you can study that. Delamination in composite materials could be viewed in the same way. Honeycomb materials, so these sorts of things are often used in sandwich panels like this to get lightweight walls and floors in aircraft and naval vessels. And these things can buckle and deform under large enough compressive loads, or if you've got loads in plane where you're applying, say, displacements at the top here, you get what looks like initially uniform deformation, but then eventually you get a localization and a buckling or an instability in those structures that can be studied in this sort of way. Thin films can have all of these puckering types of solutions that come under various loads. You can get these sorts of snake-like patterns that come out from a homogeneous uniform configuration. You can get this sort of puckering around certain features in a thin film. Here's my favorite one. This is a shape memory alloy. So this is a material that has, at high temperatures, it has one crystal structure, so like a cubic crystal structure. And as you lower the temperature, you reach a critical temperature. There's this instability phase transition to a different crystal structure, which might be orthorhombic or monoclinic. I'll explain those a little bit more later if you don't know what those are. And then that change in symmetry from cubic to orthorhombic or monoclinic leads to the formation of very complex and interesting microstructures in the materials. So these are micrographs. Here we have both phases of the material. This is basically at the transition temperature, where we have some of the material is in one of the equilibrium phases, and another part is in another equilibrium phase. And in fact, these different colors are then different, what are called variants of the monoclinic phase. So the variants are different spatial orientations of that monoclinic structure. And these microstructures are formed so that the material doesn't rip itself apart, basically. And so we can see this, and this is a shape memoriale of copper, aluminum, nickel. This is barium titanate, which is a ferroelectric. And this is a magnesium, gallium, arsenide magnetic shape memoriality. And so in all cases, we've got this sort of phase transition between different crystal structures, and the desire of the material not to basically rip itself apart or break into a million different pieces causes the formation of these very complex sort of laminar or needle-like microstructures. Then we can go down even further in scale. Nanoparticles can be viewed. So this is a simulation that one of my colleagues did of phase transition, basically, in a nanoparticle under different levels of pressure. So at low pressures, it takes on a relatively open equilibrium structure, and as you increase the pressure, eventually the thing densifies and collapses to a different equilibrium structure. And again, that can be described by mapping out these equilibrium structures as a function of the load. These are pretty cool things, two-phase type materials. So these are called GUVs, giant unilaminar vesicles. So this is a biomaterial composed of basically a single membrane that closes on itself to create what's called a vesicle. And these are basically lipid bilayer membranes. And in fact, it's the whole membrane is made of a single material. And it turns out that material has two phases or two equilibrium configurations which it can take up. And basically, those equilibrium configurations correspond to different curvatures of the membrane. So the red here is showing a high curvature phase or equilibrium configuration of the membrane, and the blue corresponds to a lower curvature configuration. And so depending on the environment and the loading in some sense that these GUVs are subjected to, the structure takes up the different equilibrium configurations at different points in the structure, and produces these rather striking, nice pictures, which I think are nice to look at. And so people have been studying these from this sort of point of view. And finally, there is another nice biological example of a material that actually has some life behavior in it that can be thought of in terms of this sort of instability or transition between stable and unstable equilibrium configurations. And that's this virus, which is known, I think, as the T4 virus. It's one of the best studied viruses in the world. It doesn't do anything particularly bad or anything like that. It just happens to be relatively simple. It was discovered a long time ago and has become a common test case to try to understand the mechanisms of viruses. And so these are artist renditions, obviously. But so, you know, how does a virus work? Well, it has some DNA that it has to get into a cell in order to replicate and reproduce itself. And so so this is a picture down here of the cell wall in some sense. And this particular virus has this structure. The DNA is stored in this capsid or this head of the virus. And then inside here, this little tube thing here, there's this basically needle, atomistic needle that has a hole through which the virus, the DNA can be passed, unwound and passed through to pass into the cell. And then surrounding that needle is this thing called the tail sheath. So this is the tail of the virus, and there's a sheath surrounding the needle. And the way that the virus actually attacks the cell and penetrates the cell is the following. So as it's out floating around in the protoplasm, it's sitting in a configuration kind of like this. And when it finally finds a cell, it kind of attaches to the cell in a way like this. And these sort of legs at the bottom here are just kind of floating around initially. When it gets to the cell, those legs sort of attach to the surface of the cell. And that process of going from kind of floating to attached provides a stimulus here. So there's basically sort of a twisting or a rotation or a force applied at the bottom of this tail sheath. And that's enough of a stimulus to cause this configuration of the tail sheath, this sort of extended configuration, to become unstable. And there's a transition then to a different configuration, which actually causes this tail sheath to essentially twist and shorten. And what that does, that twisting and shortening process is a dynamic process that transitions to a much shorter and fatter sort of equilibrium configuration of the tail sheath. But in the process, what that does is it actually drives the needle through the wall of the cell. And that's the mechanism by which the cell is penetrated. And then once that occurs, then the DNA can be emptied from the capsid out through the needle into the cell, and the cell is then infected. And so it's a very interesting biological mechanism that's taking advantage of the existence of instability in two phases or two equilibrium configurations in a nonlinear system. Okay, so there's kind of a wide, broad view of the sorts of applications I think you can use this sort of scientific and mathematical and computational approach to study and gain some understanding of these sorts of systems. So now let's look at really a prototypical example, exactly what goes into and what are all the details of this sort of calculation. So I'll remind you that all of the basic physics gets built into this model energy with some definition of the configuration and some definition of the loading. So let's say, you know, here the loading would be defined as, say, the angle at which these arms are make relative to the horizontal plate of the sheath, say. Whatever is appropriate for your system. And then we're looking for the equilibrium configurations. And once we find those, we're interested in, are they stable or not? So we can understand how the stable structures, the stable configurations of the system change as the parameter changes. Okay, so here's the prototypical problem we're going to look at. It's going to have a single, actually 2 degrees of freedom in general. So it's going to be simply this very simple two-bar truss, which is a finite dimensional model of an arch structure. So you can think of this maybe as a very simple model of a bridge, which can be loaded at the center of the bridge, and it can, as a result of the load, can be deformed in a particular type of way. So here's sort of the engineering diagram of such a thing. We've got pins that are fixed to the earth at these points, but these bars then are going to be rigid, or not rigid, but straight links that can rotate about these pins, and are connected by a pin up at the top here, so that that we've got a structure kind of like this. And it's hard to do with my hands because I have to move the supports. But the supports at the bottoms here are fixed. And as you load the structure, applying load to these bars allows them to be contracted or extended in a straight manner. And so it's possible then, as you load it, that this structure deforms, and it's possible to actually invert the structure to an inverted configuration, or to have it deform in a asymmetric sort of way, so that a typical generic configuration of the structure is that, measured from the unloaded zero lambda configuration, we have a vertical downward displacement V of this node, or of this point vertex, and a horizontal rightward displacement U. And so that would be a typical configuration, in which case the bar on the left and the bar on the right, which are initially of the same length, would deform to new lengths, L1 and L2, defined purely by the geometry. So the force displacement relationship is essentially a slightly nonlinear relationship here. So if the original length of these bars is capital L, and the current or deformed length is L1 or L2, then we have a sort of a strain-like measure, which is this nonlinear term here. It's the change in the square of the lengths. Actually, just that thing inside the brackets is the strain-like measure. So it's zero when the length is the original length, and as the length changes, you get a non-zero term. And the square of that is related to the energy. And so the force that is given in the bar due to a given change in length is determined by a modulus, basically. So a Young's modulus and a cross-sectional area, if you're thinking about some sort of finite size of these bars. So that the total force, say, here in this bar is L2 squared over L1 squared minus 1 times EA. And so the total sort of potential energy of this system, then, there's the energy of the two bars and the energy of the applied load if we're doing soft device. So if we're going to control the amount of load that's applied, then there's an energy term that gives a potential of that applied load. And so we've got energy of two bars with the coefficient factored out, and the potential energy of the applied load, which is the magnitude of the load times the displacement through which it would act. And for future reasons, I've included an imperfection parameter in the system. So nominally, we should consider this parameter C to be zero, so that the system is completely symmetric, so that the stiffness of the bar on the left is the same as the bar on the right. And then a little bit later, we're going to look at what happens when you change that C value to non-zero values, and you break the symmetry of this system so that it's no longer symmetric about this vertical axis, but there's a difference in stiffness between the left and the right-hand sides. And at the same time as I discuss this, I want to discuss slightly different problem formulation, as opposed to specifying how much load we apply to the structure, which is what I call a soft loading device. I want to consider the hard loading device case, where you actually specify the displacement that the structure is subjected to. So under a displacement control scenario or a hard device, we would actually control or specify the value of V here, and then we would get out as part of the equilibrium solution the value of the load that needs to be applied, or the value of the load that's generated in the structure that's conjugate to that applied displacement. Okay, so in that case, then, your energy for the hard device, the only free degree of freedom that's free to vary is the horizontal displacement, and the loading parameter, then, is now the vertical displacement. So this is a case where the loading parameter is a displacement as applied as opposed to a force, which is the case here, where we've got 2 degrees of freedom in our configuration space and a force-type loading parameter. Okay, so we can take derivatives of these things with respect to their configuration variables. That gives us the equilibrium equations. It turns out with these particular functional forms, you can analytically solve for all the equilibrium equations for that system. And if I plot those solutions, let's look specifically at the load control case at this point. If I plot those solutions, essentially what we get is a bifurcation diagram. And this turns out to be what you get in this case. So in this case, we've got a plot of the load, lambda, as a function of the downward displacement of the apex, V. And here we've got the horizontal displacement versus the vertical displacement. And so let's walk through what's happening here. So it turns out we can see we've got two branches of equilibria. So So the red branch is what I would call the principal branch. It turns out to have the horizontal displacement always being zero, so this is where we retain perfect symmetry of the system. And then the blue branch actually has non-zero values of u, and so that's where we've broken symmetry and we have gone off into this asymmetric type of configuration. And it turns out that if you look at if those configurations are stable or not, you get this sort of bifurcation diagram. So at zero value of load in this sort of reference or undeformed configuration, v is zero, and so we're here, and it's a good thing that that's stable. We would expect that that sort of structure to sit there and not diverge under any sorts of perturbations. But then if we were to start pulling up instead of down on this system, that would correspond to negative values of lambda, and that would mean that this point would move upward, which would give us a negative v, and so that looks like a nice stable behavior. So as we decrease lambda, we would follow this part of the curve, and basically just stretch that structure out in the vertical direction. But if we do the more typical thing, like we put a car on a bridge, that would be applying a load lambda that's positive. And so for small values of lambda, we follow the stable equilibrium solution here, follow this curve up until we reach the first critical point, that bifurcation point. And after we reach a value of load that's here, if we increment the load just slightly, there's nowhere along the line nearby for that value of load that has a stable equilibrium configuration. So nowhere in here is there a stable equilibrium. So we'll expect the system to dynamically transition to whatever other equilibria there are, and that's just this guy over here. So there would be basically a dynamic jump of the system from this sort of configuration over to this sort of configuration, which has a very large value of V. And so that's the scenario where you can imagine that if you've got this structure, you're pushing down on it, eventually you push hard enough that the thing actually just snaps through dynamically. And I can give you a very practical example of this. If you remember like baby food jars, at least in the States, or just your jam jar, that has a safety seal, right? So you know if the jar has been opened or not. It has that vacuum seal lid. So that's a sort of bistable state that exhibits just this sort of snap-through behavior. If you take it, you unscrew it, and put your finger on top and push down a little bit, it'll give you kind of a click, snap-through type of sound. And if you take your finger off, it snaps back into the original position. So this sort of click-clack type of instability that occurs. So that's a very hands-on sort of example of behavior that we're getting out of this sort of model. So of course, once you've got it to snap through, if you continue to push downward, you're just going to follow this stable equilibrium configuration at larger values of load. But if you start to lower the load, in this case, you can come all the way down here and start actually pulling on the structure. And so in this case, this model, you would actually, the baby food jar would snap through and stay down. And you'd actually have to push on the other side to snap it back up. And so you would get a snap through that comes back to the original system. So this is sort of a two-state system that you can control which configuration. And of course, we see that there's this bifurcated branch. Turns out it actually creates a closed loop between these two bifurcation points. But it turns out in this particular model that branch is always unstable, so it's always a saddle point in the energy landscape. Okay. But the picture changes a little bit if we, instead of doing load control, we actually grab this node and control where it is in the vertical axis. And that's this hard device type of load, which really simply just knocks off this term here and gets rid of lambda and treats V is the loading parameter. And it turns out, in fact, in that case, you get exactly the same set of equilibrium solutions. So the equilibrium solution is exactly the same, but the interpretation of stability now becomes different. So because you're actually specifying this position in V, then there's a possibility that there's a different measure of stability. So in this case, it turns out that when you control V, the bifurcated solution then actually is interpreted as stable. And so given a value of V, the system has to pick up one of these three equilibrium configurations. Turns out that being centered, so for instance, if you're quite a ways down, turns out that you can reach a lower energy configuration by moving the node to the right or left than you have by keeping both bars the same length. And so it turns out, again, this part is still unstable, just like in the load control case, but now the bifurcated solution becomes stable under the displacement control consideration.
And grab some water.
So that's kind of a description of this basic system, and you can see how you can really understand what will happen, what will be the behavior of the system quite easily through the bifurcation diagram. So any questions at this point on what we've looked at? Yeah?
Well, what happened if the form of the energy here it changes if we add the dissipation in the system, for example, the bar?
If we add saving?
Dissipation.
So, right, so the sort of scenario that I've described where the system follows this curve and then jumps over here and follows this curve, in reality, that actually assumes that there's some overall dissipation of the system, because if you looked at the energies of, you know, here and here, you'd see that this has a much lower energy. And so in a purely conservative system, what would actually happen is the system would dynamically, you know, if you were up here at zero velocity, you would slowly start to convert, transitioning, you'd build up velocity, build up momentum, and then you'd start just wildly oscillating about this equilibrium configuration. Almost all structures and systems have some form of dissipation in them. And so what we often typically see is that we can interpret these sorts of things as if they had dissipation, and that the system will dynamically transition, and then the dissipation will cause the system to eventually come to rest at an equilibrium, at a nearby stable equilibrium. So the analysis would not have to be particularly different. Although the actual details of the dissipation that you have in your system would affect how the system does this sort of transition. So the exact path through which you see this, and how much sort of oscillation there might be as you reach these points would be controlled by the dynamics of the system, which I haven't fully accounted for in this case. So if you really want to understand those sorts of dynamical properties and behavior, then you have to build sort of on top of this sort of understanding of the system. Very good question, thank you. So now we're gonna actually look at what happens as we perturb the system or introduce imperfection. And we'll actually, what I hope to show you from this is that it makes a lot of sense to study perfect systems from this point of view, because understanding the perfect system gives you a relatively deep understanding of what the imperfect system, how the imperfect system is going to behave. So here is the behavior for the perfect system, where we have zeta is equal to zero, and that means that there's a symmetry in the system corresponding to the mirror plane that is a vertical. Now if we actually make a small perturbation to that system, we break that symmetry, but only a little bit, and we recompute the equilibrium structure of the problem, where now this is non-zero. For a very small value of imperfection, this is the sort of equilibrium structure behavior that we have. It's a bit difficult to see the difference here, but you'll see a better idea of what the difference is if I increase the magnitude of this perturbation. So we see a slightly larger value, we can see what's happened. Actually, there's no longer a bifurcation point. These two equilibrium sets have decoupled or become disjoint. Although it's quite interesting that what was one single path, this bifurcated path that was a circle, And another one that was high symmetry, the perfectly vertical case that was straight through here and up, down, up. So that those two paths have split into two pieces and mixed and matched in a way. So that there's a single primary path that is initially almost perfectly straight, but then eventually, as you start to move up here, there's a slight amount of swaying to one side, but then at some critical value of the load, here you get a large deviation. It's rather relatively quick, but large deviation in the horizontal displacement, and it actually follows this curve around until you get to the fully snapped through configuration, and if you pull it hard enough, it goes more and more perfectly vertically straight. So this is the behavior that you would expect to see then if you started loading a structure from zero load back here or here. But then we also see that there's actually another set of behavior that's possible for this system, but that you wouldn't find if you were to just actually do the experiment. You wouldn't typically find, let's say. And that would be this part of the equilibrium structure. And in fact, there is a whole stable portion of that configuration. And so you could actually load the structure and physically place it in one of those configurations, like say here, and the structure would be relatively happy to sit there. Now, in a real system, if you looked at the energy associated with these structures, you would find that this configuration for the given value of load has a lower energy than this configuration. So that the blue and the red that are overlapping here correspond to similar equilibria, but higher energy, one is higher energy than the other. And so you would expect if there are sort of maybe thermal fluctuations or something like that, that if you're looking for a true absolute global energy minimum configuration, you would expect the red curve, but the blue curve is sort of equally valid, nearly equally valid. And as you continue to increase the imperfection parameter, there's a relatively smooth sort of morphing or variation of the qualitative behavior of the system. And so if you go into larger and larger systems, it looks relatively the same. You get a larger variation of horizontal variation at lower values of load, but qualitatively the behavior is the same. And if you go really far away, so this is now this bar is twice as stiff as this one. Again, we see that there's still the same qualitative behavior. But again, if you had started by studying this problem that has no symmetry and this sort of behavior, you would most likely have only found this portion of the behavior of the system. And you would have been ignorant or completely unknown about this part of the system, just because it would be quite unlikely that you would explore the system well enough to identify that. However, if you start from the fully symmetric system, you sort of know about that portion of the system's behavior from the beginning, and then you can interpret what will happen as you start to perturb the system and understand that as you make this number bigger, this is just going to smoothly vary in this sort of way. Okay. That's kind of the big picture of how I do these bifurcation techniques and how I think they're quite useful for understanding what models of this type predict. But now, of course, there's the question of, okay, if I give you a functional form like this, can you construct these sorts of diagrams? And that's going to be the next part of the class here. It'll be this section. The first thing we'll do is how do I follow, say, this red curve, and then once we know how to follow red curves, we'll ask how do I identify these points. If I'm following this curve, how do I notice that there's a bifurcation point? And once I've noticed there's a bifurcation point, how do I find the blue curve that also crosses at that bifurcation point? And so we'll look at some numerical tools. Okay, so as we've seen, symmetry plays quite a bit of importance in these cases, so we go back again. It is, in fact, quite generically the loss of symmetry that indicates a bifurcation point. And so what's happening at this bifurcation point is that a high symmetry solution, the red solution that has this mirror symmetry, is intersecting with a lower symmetry solution, which breaks that mirror symmetry. But as it goes through this point, it recovers that symmetry. So from this point, we find low symmetry equilibrium paths emerging from a high symmetry equilibrium path. And so taking advantage of the symmetry of the equations that you have in this way is actually quite important for doing these sorts of path following or branch following types of numerics. So the first thing we need to talk about is a little bit of group theory and symmetry techniques. And I'm just going to show you kind of the results. And if you're interested, we can talk further at some other time about how you prove these sorts of results. OK, so we'll work with kind of a square symmetry as an example. But the basic point here is that a symmetry is represented by an invariance in the energy. So if I've got my energy in some configuration and some value of load, a symmetry is typically indicated by the fact that there exists another configuration, which is, in some sense, symmetry-related, which will have the same energy. So certainly, if they're symmetry-related, we would expect there to be the same energy for the structure. And so what this invariance relationship is saying is that there's some operation, in this case it's a linear, basically a matrix operator, that can apply to the configuration, give me a new configuration. And if this structure or these equations, this energy has that this is a symmetry, this Tg is a symmetry, then the energy that you get by evaluating this quantity will be the same as the energy you get using the original configuration. So in other words, in this case, this configuration will have exactly the same energy as if I use minus u and have the thing, the node over here in the symmetric configuration. So this is the mathematical way of representing that. And it turns out that you're usually going to have multiple symmetry operations, and so those things will form a group. So you've got some representative element of a group, and for each one of those symmetry operations, you'll have a matrix that can map a configuration to the symmetrically related configuration. Okay, so if you have an energy with this sort of group invariant structure that satisfies this equation, then just by doing careful derivatives of this, you can actually prove that the equilibrium equations, or the gradient of the energy, so I'm going to actually kind of switch a little bit now, that I'm going to use capital F as the symbol for the equilibrium equations. You should typically just think of that as the derivative of the energy with respect to the configuration variables. Okay, so from here you can prove that if you take the gradient, you get the equilibrium equations, and the equilibrium equations satisfy this sort of invariance relationship. It's not quite invariance. It's not invariant, but it's what we call equivariance. And it says that the forces, or the outer balance forces in the equilibrium equations for some given configuration x are related to the forces in a symmetry-related configuration through the same transformation. So if you transform the forces in the same way as you do the configuration, then you'll get the forces on the transformed configuration, or the symmetry-related configuration. So let me go here. Let's say I take this configuration and I apply a force also in the horizontal direction, so then I'd have a lambda and a force in the horizontal. Then to get to the symmetry-related configuration, I'd have to apply the same lambda, so you use the same v, so I would use the same lambda. And to get over here, I transform u to minus u. And so the force that would be needed to hold this structure over here would actually have a force that's negative the force that's required here. So you use the same linear mapping to get the transformed forces as you do the transformed configuration. And that's just, that equivariance is just a fact of life that comes from the invariance of the energy. So once you have this structure, you can do a lot of things with linear representation theory in the theory of groups. And I need to summarize a few of those theorems and results for you so that we can take advantage of them. So one of the things you can do is actually identify all configurations that are invariant under the group, so that they have all of the symmetries of the group that you're interested in. So it turns out that you can identify all the configurations in your configuration space that have the symmetry by saying, by which I mean that the mapping of the configuration by a symmetry gives you back the same configuration. So there's no, although you've applied a mapping, it turns out not to actually affect the configuration. So again, an example here, any configuration for which U is zero will have the symmetry. And so a mapping of U to minus U maps zero to zero and maps it to the same configuration. So that's an invariant set of configurations, all of which have U equal to zero. And so this is just a way of writing that statement. And so that defines a subspace of the configuration group. And it turns out you can actually, from the group theory, you can get an expression for the dimension of that subspace. And you can do it just by some simple algebra. So if you take all of the transformation matrices for your group, you take the trace of those matrices, and then you add up those traces, and you divide by the number of elements in the group, so the number of symmetry operations. Turns out that you can prove using some linear algebra and group theory that is actually the dimension of this subspace of invariant configurations. Pretty cool stuff, in fact. I wouldn't expect you to have any idea why that should be. It's a relatively deep result of linear representation theory. But it is quite useful. And then you can extend things a little bit further, and it turns out, so you can solve your equilibrium equations. You can look for solutions that are in this symmetric subspace. So you look for all equilibrium configurations that have the full symmetry of the structure. And those would be called G-symmetric solutions because they have the symmetry of the group G, and those configurations are in that subspace. And just so we have a concrete example of what a group is, what I mean by a group, and that sort of thing, we have an example here. So if you've got a configuration that has square symmetry, or a system that can have square symmetry, then that means you've got a system with symmetry operations of rotations of 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270, and 0. And then you also get mirror planes about the horizontal, the vertical, the horizontal, and diagonals. And so you can name these things. So sigma can stand for a mirror plane, and 1, 3, you can set up some notation. C4 stands for a fourfold rotation, so that's 90 degrees. It takes 4 of those to get back to 0, or 360. And so you can define this sort of abstract group by listing these symbols. So you've got E for the identity group, no transformation, 90 degree rotation in the opposite direction, or equivalently a 270 rotation, 180 rotation, and then the three mirrors, or the four mirror types, possible types of mirror planes. And so these things are generically represented in these equations by the lowercase g, the whole thing by a capital G. And it turns out if you have a way of multiplying these things, applying first a rotation and then a mirror, or a rotation followed by another rotation, then you can actually generate all 8 of these symmetry elements just by starting from a 90 degree rotation and a single mirror and applying them sequentially. You'll actually get to all of those. So those are called generators. Okay, so this is pretty cool. It's nice that we can think about finding all the solutions that have a certain symmetry, but actually doing that is difficult unless you know what this space is, unless you have a reasonable way of finding that symmetric subspace. And it turns out that group theory gives you a really nice, almost algorithmic formula for finding that subspace. And it gives you a way to construct a projection operator from your full configuration space into the symmetric subspace. And again, it turns out to be a simple algebraic formula in terms of these representation matrices, these matrices that transform the configuration in a way according to a symmetry. So it turns out you just take all of those matrices, and instead of taking the trace, you just take the full matrix itself, add them all together, and again divide by the size of the group, the number of elements, 8 in the case of the square up group, and you get a matrix. And it turns out if you look at that matrix, it's an idempotent projection matrix. So it has the property that for any vector in this symmetric subspace, you apply that matrix to that vector, you get the vector back, it's unchanged. And any vector that's not in the space, so it's in the orthogonal complement to that subspace, turns out that this matrix maps it to the zero vector. Another way of saying this is that this P matrix, this projection operator, has all of its eigenvalues as either 0 or 1. And the 0 eigenvalue is the eigenvectors associated with the 0 eigenvalues form a basis for the orthogonal complement space, and the eigenvectors associated with eigenvalue 1 form a basis for the invariant subspace. And again, this is a relatively amazing theorem that can be proved via the theory of linear representations of groups. All you have to do is take this sort of sum and get this sort of operator very nicely. And so this is, it's very nice to have a way of getting vectors that belong to this space, but it's sort of computationally, it'd be very nice to map that into a smaller dimensional space so that you're working only with components in an isomorphic space at least. So we'd like to construct a mapping that takes us from our full configuration space, Rn, to the actual subspace of, no, sorry, that's not quite what I want. This should be lowercase m, so that it's a lower dimensional space, so the dimension of the invariant subspace, so that's this quantity. So that's going to be m, so we're going to assume there are m of those, so there's m eigenvalues equal to 1 in this projection, and this guy is going to map us from a generic vector in R sub m, or R little m, to a vector in R large n, which this is a subspace of. I hope that's somewhat clear. So we can do that by taking an orthonormal set of eigenvectors of this operator with eigenvalue 1 and concatenating them into a non-square matrix so that each one of these things is going to have capital N components and there'll be M of them. So this is capital N rows and M columns. And so that will be something that maps a vector in R sub m to a vector in R capital N. And by choosing these vectors as sort of basis vectors, we'll be guaranteed that the configuration that we get is something that belongs to this invariant subspace. And yeah, so that's what this is saying. So m is the dimension here, and then turns out that this invariant subspace is, by construction, the span of these eigenvectors. Once we have that, we have a nice way of actually, even numerically, taking our full set of equations and reducing it down to a set of equations on the invariant subspace. So in fact, so we know that by equivariance, of course, the equilibrium equations, their value when we evaluate them on a configuration actually belongs to that subspace. So that comes from applying this equation. So that if we evaluated a symmetric configuration, the forces that we get back also have the full symmetry of the system. That can be shown. So in other words, you know, back here, if u is equal to zero, then there's no way that we can get a non-zero horizontal force generated by the system. So it has to be, by symmetry, it has to be in equilibrium at that zero value of u. And so that's what this is saying. And so now that we've got all the pieces in place, we can actually construct what's called the restriction of the equilibrium equations to the fully symmetric subspace. So we can define a restricted set of equilibrium equations, f sub g, as the restriction of this function to the symmetric subspace. And so that's f sub g, which is going to be a function of some vector v, which is in an m-dimensional space, and lambda, and it's just defined as you take v, you map it into sg, so now it's an n-dimensional vector. So you can evaluate that here. And then we know that this thing is in sg, so that this is also in sg, so we can map that back to a n or m-dimensional vector here, so that we get something that takes values m, m values, and returns m force components. And so this is, in a sense, throwing out equilibrium equations which are identically satisfied due to symmetry condition. So in the 2 by truss case, in the symmetric case, this is saying as long as u is zero, we don't have to worry about the equilibrium condition in the u direction. We know it'll be zero, so we want to get rid of it altogether and not actually try to compute zero is equal zero. Alright. So with this sort of thing, then we can actually find solutions to these reduced equations. Of course, it's simpler numerically to solve a smaller set of equations than a larger set of equations. So we've gained some computational efficiency in some sense in this way. And through all this construction, we can see that there's actually a one-to-one mapping between solutions of this smaller symmetry-reduced system and solutions to the full system of equations. So if we have a solution here, then we know that if we just map that solution into the symmetric subspace, that will be a solution of our full problem that we're interested in. So that's going to be very nice, because what it does is actually eliminate a lot of other solutions, these lower symmetry solutions, that we might not be interested in as we want to follow the path, follow a single equilibrium branch or path. So for instance here, we'll be interested in following the red curve, but as we get close to this point, the equations are going to become ill-conditioned because there are multiple solutions near that point. But as we're following the red curve, we're not really interested in the blue curve for the moment. And so this symmetry reduction actually allows us to throw out this blue solution and get a system of equations for which there are only the red solutions. And then, actually near this point, there's no problem in continuing to follow that sort of path. So that's why we need all these symmetry reduction techniques. So just as you can get a kind of an example to understand this symmetry reduction technique, let's look at a sample problem. So imagine we've got some point masses, so four of them connected by linear strings in this sort of configuration where this would be in an unstretched zero force configuration. So it's an equilibrium configuration with the strings at their natural lengths. And now we want to imagine applying loads forces to the masses and see what happens, understand the equilibrium configurations that can be taken up by this system. And we're going to apply those loads so that they retain the cubic or the square symmetry of the configuration, so that they're all pointing towards the center. And in this case, since the configuration is square, we still have full symmetry of the system, 90 degree rotations, and mirror planes. So the magnitude of each of these guys will be equal. And so if we have that symmetry, okay, so the basic configurational space then is going to be the displacements of each of the four mass points. So So we've got a displacement in the horizontal of mass 1 and a vertical of mass 1, horizontal of mass 2, vertical of mass 2, et cetera, et cetera. So we've got an eight-dimensional configuration space. And we want to reduce that configuration space so that we look for only square configurations. And probably you can all tell me exactly how I could do that just intuitively in this sort of case, but the tools and techniques that we've been talking about here are kind of generic. They'll do this in much more complicated cases where you don't have the intuition to pick that out, that the solution out automatically. So a total energy in this case would be the k delta squared for the springs, and then a potential of the applied loads. It's just a dot product between the applied load vector and the displacement vector. And if we write down the matrices that would map, would correspond to a symmetry operation of this structure and act on this eight-dimensional space, we'll get those T sub G quantities. So for instance, if I do a mirror plane about this vertical axis, well then node 4 would get mapped to node 1. So that would mean actually the displacement at node 4 would be applied to node 1. But we also need to account for the mirror plane, the mirror action on the displacement. So we would want the displacement in the horizontal direction to be negative. So you would take U21 and take that value and put it here with a minus sign. And then you take U22, the vertical, and just apply that to node 1. So that would go here. And same thing for these guys. This would go here with a minus sign, and this would go here. And similar for nodes 3 and 4. And if you think about that, you can write that down as a linear transformation or a matrix that maps this vector to the transform vector. So you do that for all 8 of these, of the symmetries of the square group. And then you apply that formula. So this formula to those 8 matrices. And you look at that, you pull out the eigenvectors that are associated with eigenvalue 1. And actually what you find is that, where is it? This formula right here, when you take the trace of those, you actually just get 1. So there's only, it's a one-dimensional symmetric subspace. And when you use this formula then, you get that matrix, you find that there's only 1 eigenvalue equal to 1, and the eigenvector that's associated with that eigenvalue is this guy. So it's a normalized vector that has, you know, displacements of this node in the 1-1 direction, so towards the center dot. Displacements of node 2 is 1 minus 1, so that's displacements along this line. And similarly, this guy displaces inward or outward along this line, and this one inward or outward along that line. And so any multiple of this displacement vector will lead you to a configuration that still has square symmetry, just with a different side length than the original. And so that technique has actually showed us that we can work with this one-dimensional space to look at all the square configurations. We can reduce our full set of 8 equilibrium equations for this system that we get by taking derivatives of this thing with respect to all 8 degrees of freedom to a single degree of freedom equation for the square symmetric cases. You do that by, you know, using this vector with some scalar magnitude v and applying the vector to basically the dot product between the force and this vector. That gives you a scalar equation for V in terms of lambda, the magnitude of these applied loads. And it turns out, you know, this is a linear problem. In fact, so you can solve that identically. You get that V has got to be lambda over square root of 2k, where k is the stiffness of the springs. And so the full system, set of solutions for this system that have square symmetry can be given as U as a function of, in this case, V, which you can substitute in, so U is a function of lambda, and they would be given by this sort of configuration vector. So you can see There's quite a bit of nice simplification that can be obtained if you take advantage of the symmetry that you have in your system. And so the next thing then would be to start to talk about how we, once we've taken advantage of those symmetries, so once we've reduced the system to the symmetry of an equilibrium path, I guess that's something I didn't explicitly say, you can prove in these cases that equilibrium paths for systems with symmetry always have the same symmetry. So essentially every point on an equilibrium path has the same symmetry. And so that's why it's nice to be able to reduce the equation so that you're solving along a given path. You're solving the minimum number of equations needed to determine the path itself, and not spending a lot of extra time solving equations that are essentially equal to zero is equal to zero. And so that's why we have all this symmetry stuff. So the next part here will be, how do we start following one of these paths once we've made that reduction? I've reached a good time to take a break, I think, at this point. So we will take about a 15-minute break and try to get going right at 2:45. Thanks for your attention so far. Any questions? Good question. So if the symmetry here, I'm talking about the symmetry of the equations, not necessarily a local symmetry. So we really need this sort of symmetry, that the equations are invariant under this full set of operations. Or in other words, you have this sort of thing as a function. So this has to be true for all x. And this has to be true for all configurations. And so you want to take the largest set of symmetry operations that's true for all x. Good question. All right, so we'll take a break. And we're going to assume that we know some solution to these equations, probably or most typically the value lambda is equal to zero, and often that means x, so the configuration is equal to zero. Typically that's a common known solution point. And so the picture is that we know this point here, and we want to be able to follow this equilibrium path. Of course, there's actually a mathematical question of how do we know there's actually a nice equilibrium path that goes through that point. So the first thing that we do on this slide is kind of very quickly prove mathematically that there's that there will typically be a solution path that we can follow numerically. So if we have this set of equations and we know a solution, and this set of equations is some sort of smooth map, then we can typically assume, this is an assumption in the theorem, assume that the gradient of that function, or in other words, the stiffness matrix, second derivative of an energy, in that term, we can assume that that's a regular matrix. So it's a square matrix. And we can assume that it's non-singular. So all of its eigenvalues are non-zero. If that's the case, which is typically the case, it's very special in a way to have a zero, exactly zero eigenvalue, then we have a regular stiffness. And since this is a function in n variables plus one, then the implicit function theorem will guarantee for us that we can solve that system as a, or in other words, that this system implicitly defines a function x of lambda, at least in the neighborhood of the known solution point x0 and lambda 0. So just by making that argument, we've used the implicit function theorem to say that there is a continuous set of solutions or a solution curve, at least in the neighborhood of this point. And in fact, that theorem says that there are some values, alpha 0 and alpha 1, in terms of sort of arc length along the path, for which we're guaranteed that there's a solution path between. And so we can extend that by sort of iteratively using the implicit function theorem to guarantee that there is some finite range here of solutions. And that's guaranteed up to these points, alpha 1 and alpha 0. And presumably then, those points are where the assumptions of the implicit function theorem fail, meaning that the Jacobian or the Hessian becomes singular. So we know mathematically now that we can actually follow this path up to singular points or critical points of bifurcation. But how would we actually do that? So of course, the simplest numerical technique for doing such a thing is what I tend to call incremental Newton-Raphson. Newton-Raphson is a very nice numerical algorithm for solving systems of equations. And if you add a parameter into a system of equations, then you can solve the system using Newton-Raphson over and over with different values of the parameter. So here's a very typical Newton-Raphson solution scheme. You have some guess, y for the configuration. While the equations are not satisfied, you update the solution with using the inverse of the Jacobian or the inverse of the stiffness applied to the forces. You update the solution, and you do this until the forces all go to zero, and you find an equilibrium. And now if you just augment that with a way to choose a new value of lambda and an initial guess for a new solution on this curve, you can get this incremental Newton-Raphson scheme. So we assume we know this value. We're given a step size in lambda. And so to find the next point along the curve, we increment lambda by the given amount, delta lambda. And then we use Newton-Raphson to solve the equations down to find this point. Once you found that point, increment lambda again. Here we've got once we've got two points, you can use a secant predictor to, instead of just using the previous value of x as a guess, you can use a secant prediction to get a better prediction for the location of the new point on the curve, which will hopefully converge more quickly in the Newton-Raphson iteration. And you can then just march up this equilibrium curve by incrementing lambda over and over. And this sort of very simple technique will work quite well to numerically map out points along this curve up to various special cases, in a sense. Does that make sense? Okay, so what sort of problems can we run into? Well, in this case, the first thing that's at least easy to point out here is that we don't really know, sort of even mathematically, that there's a solution curve to follow past this point. So basically, this sort of path-following algorithm can follow the curve from alpha 0 to alpha 1, where alpha 1 is where we've hit the critical point. And so now we have the question, well, can we continue it past that point? Does it make sense mathematically and numerically? And so here we can define these sorts of critical points. So a point in this mapping where the stiffness matrix is of rank less than full rank, meaning there are some zero eigenvalues, basically, then that's, by definition, going to be a critical point. So that's one of these sorts of special points where implicit function theorem fails. And it turns out that if you do some analysis of that, you can categorize the possible types of critical points. And it turns out there are sort of two. There's symmetry, they can be split into symmetry breaking and symmetry preserving critical points. And once you've done that, it turns out that you, by using slightly different techniques in these two cases, you can prove that you can always continue your equilibrium path solution past the critical point in either case. So we can always extend it, but it takes different techniques. Okay, so in the first case, where we have what we call a symmetry breaking critical point, so this is going to turn out to be a bifurcation point where you've been following a high symmetry path and you found a bifurcation point, and then a lower symmetry path crosses the high symmetry path at that point. And so you get a symmetry breaking bifurcation point, we say. And there's actually a criterion to identify when you have a symmetry breaking bifurcation point, and it comes into the symmetry reduction problem. So actually, yeah, the notation's a little inconsistent here, so I apologize for that. But the point is that here, if we're following our equilibrium path using the full set of equations without any symmetry reduction, then we will, at the critical point, we'll see a critical point, and that means that there will be a zero eigenvalue, and therefore the determinant of the Hessian or the stiffness matrix will be zero for that full system. However, if we're actually using the reduced set of equations, so that we've eliminated the possibility of non-symmetric configurations, then it turns out that the Hessian or the stiffness matrix of the reduced set of equations actually is no longer singular, because the only equilibrium points, equilibrium configurations that emerge from that bifurcation point have lower symmetry than the path you've been following. And the symmetry reduction actually eliminates the possibility of those configurations. You can't actually even describe those configurations in terms of the V degrees of freedom. And so basically the zero eigenvalues here have been thrown away by the symmetry reduction. And so if you were following with the full set of equations and you found a critical point, and you looked at the reduced set of equations and you saw that in that case it's not actually a critical point, you would be able to recognize this as a symmetry breaking bifurcation point. And let me just ignore that special case for a minute. Actually, let me just skip over that special case. So the basic the result to take away here is that, in fact, if you've got a symmetry breaking bifurcation point, you can actually eliminate that critical point by working with the reduced set of equations. So, in fact, you just simply don't even see that instability or that critical point in the equilibrium equations by working with only symmetric cases. And so that's actually the answer to the question of what sort of technique do you use to follow the curve past a critical point when you have a symmetry breaking bifurcation point. So the picture is this one. Let me describe it here. You've been using the full set of equations to follow this curve. You followed it up to this critical point, and you recognize that it's a symmetry breaking critical point. So from that, then what happens is you can recognize that if you use the symmetry reduced equations, then the implicit function theorem actually allows you to extend the solution curve in the reduced equations or the reduced space out to a further point past this point alpha 1. And so actually then you can just use your same numerical technique on the reduced set of equations to follow the equilibrium path past that symmetry breaking bifurcation point. There will be no problem. So simply by using the reduced set of equations, you don't have to worry about symmetry breaking bifurcation. Actually quite a nice, one of the major features of the reasons why you want to use these symmetry reduced equations. Okay, I'm skipping some details there. The details that I'm skipping are what happens if you actually are following a low symmetry path and encounter a symmetry breaking bifurcation point for which the curve that's crossing through is actually higher symmetry. There you just have to be a little careful about which symmetry group you use to do the reduction. But I think that's not important for this sort of introduction. So then the second case was what happens when you get what are called symmetry preserving bifurcation points. And so the criterion there is that not only is the full system of equations, the Hessian, the stiffness matrix, singular, but so is the reduced set of equations. So now again, even if you use the symmetry reduced set of equations, you see a singular point or a critical point along the curve that you're trying to follow. And if you do the mathematical analysis in that case, you can prove that there are basically two possibilities for that type of critical point. Either it's what's called a symmetry preserving bifurcation point, so there's another curve that crosses through this curve that has the same symmetry, or it's what we call a turning point. Now, there's a very general argument that says that these symmetry preserving points basically don't occur. They're structurally unstable in the sense of solution orbits and dynamical systems and that sort of thing. Any arbitrarily small perturbation in the system of equations, even sort of the machine noise of finite arithmetic, will in principle transform a symmetry preserving bifurcation point into a turning point. So in some sense, what it's saying is that when you have this sort of case, if you don't have perfect symmetry, it's possible that you have two paths exactly cross, but it's more likely that you have something like this. And any small perturbation will change something where there is a perfect crossing into something like this. So really, true bifurcations occur only because there are symmetries, unless there's some amazing accident of your system. So when you see bifurcations, it's really because there's symmetries underlying the system. So I'm basically going to say, well, we're going to assume that there are no sort of accidents like this. So basically, this thing's not going to happen, so I'm going to assume that it doesn't happen. So we're just left then with, once we've worked with the reduced set of equations so that we can pass symmetry breaking bifurcation points, all we have to do is deal with turning points then that are critical points that occur on a bifurcated path. And so these are then characterized by this set of criteria, which basically says there's a local extremum in the path parameter lambda. So in other words, you have a path that looks like this. And why is this a problem? Well, it's a problem because our incremental Newton-Raphson scheme marched along in one direction in the loading parameter. And we took a value of the loading parameter, find a solution point, to start here, increment lambda, find a solution, increment lambda, find a solution. Increment lambda, there's no solution. So that can give you trouble if you're trying to follow an entire path and you have a turning point like this. So this is the sort of scenario that we're trying to get away from. And it turns out that, in principle, this sort of thing is not a problem because you can always identify a unique parameterization of the curve in terms of one of your variables, either lambda or some configuration variable. And so, in principle, it's possible to just switch the quantity that you're incrementing in the incremental Newton-Raphson scheme. So instead of incrementing lambda, you can start incrementing some value of x and start marching this way, and then you'd be okay. But of course, trying to algorithmically implement that as a computational scheme is going to be very difficult. You have to keep looking for this sort of possibility, detect when it's happening, then switch the parameter that you're updating, and it would be a real mess. And so luckily, there are better methods for dealing with this sort of problem. And so those are what we'll talk about. So I'm going to talk about two methods that I haven't really developed, but I've been working with significantly, and I've given my own names to them as acronyms. And so one, they're both going to be pseudo-arc-length methods. So instead of incrementing a parameter, we're going to try to increment the value of the arc length and follow, in some sense, the arc length of the solution path as opposed to a given component of the solution path. And so the first one we'll talk about is the simplest. It's a pseudo-arc length thing which works with a constraint. So we call it a pseudo-arc length constraint approach, or PACA. And basically the numerical technique works by approximating the arc length along the curve as the distance between two solution points on the curve. So we're going to approximate the arc length, ds, by the distance between the point that we know on the curve and the next point that we want to find. And ideally, we want that to be a distance, an arc length distance, ds away. And as we take increments of ds to be smaller and smaller, this becomes more and more accurate as an approximation. So numerically, then, what we're going to say is we actually are going to use a constraint equation like this that says we know this solution. We want to find the solution to a system of equations, which is our original equilibrium system of equations, plus a constraint equation, which says that the point that I want to find is some fixed Euclidean distance, delta s, away from the point that I know. So basically, in two dimensions, I'm looking for a point on this circle that is also on the equilibrium curve that I'm interested in. And that works actually very well. If you implement that augmented system, apply Newton-Raphson scheme to that system of equations with the input as ci and ds, that will converge quite nicely to the next point on the curve. Of course, there's a possibility of another solution on this curve, but typically if you use a scheme that takes, say, the difference between the last two points and predicts you somewhere up here, you very rarely will have a Newton-Raphson scheme that comes back to the solution you're not looking for. So usually you don't have to worry about finding this solution just by choosing a decent initial guess for your Newton-Raphson. So this is quite a robust sort of algorithm. It works quite nicely. You can augment it with step length adaption and that sort of thing. It's a very good algorithm, although there are a few disadvantages. And those are, as I said, the possibility of that solution, that second solution coming up, although that one's not such a big trouble. A somewhat more significant problem is that you've now created a non-symmetric system that's actually larger than the one you were solving before, that you have to solve with Newton-Raphson. So you've got, with Newton-Raphson, you're going to be inverting wherever it is, inverting this stiffness matrix, but now you've added a row and column associated with the corresponding elements coming from this constraint equation. The row and column that you've added aren't the same, so it's non-symmetric. And now you have to have a non-symmetric inversion matrix routine for a slightly larger system than you were working with. And so this is going to be computationally somewhat more expensive to deal with. And so that might be something that leads you to think about other possible algorithms. And so that brings us to the second algorithm, which eliminates, in some sense, those difficulties. And so that's what I call the pseudo-arc length tangent approach, PATA. And so here, instead of using the approximation of the Euclidean distance as an approximation for the arc length, it uses the projection along the tangent at the known solution. So here we assume that we have a technique for finding the tangent to the curve at a known solution point. And then we take an approximation of the arc length along that curve as a ds, a distance along this direction. And then there are some very nice and sophisticated techniques here that you can use and find an iterative predictor corrector type of path following technique based on this idea. So it turns out that there's a very nice way of finding this tangent direction, and that's by taking your equilibrium equations and treating it as a function of n plus one variables as opposed to n plus a parameter. And so if you take the full Jacobian of that function, that'll give you an n by n plus 1 matrix, which has the stiffness matrix, which was n by n, plus an extra column, which is the derivative of the equilibrium equation with respect to the loading parameter. And it turns out that that Jacobian, so we call it a Jacobian now because it's not coming from an energy, so that Jacobian will, by necessity, of course, have a zero eigenvalue. And it turns out that the eigenvector associated with that zero eigenvalue is, in fact, the tangent to the curve. And so that's a very nice thing to know. So if you've got this notation to find the tangent for this sort of Jacobian, then you can use like a QR decomposition to very easily find that tangent direction. So the approach is that once you know a point, you compute the tangent direction. We can do that efficiently. Then you compute an initial guess or a prediction of the next point on the curve by going a distance ds along that tangent direction from the known point. So that gets us here. And then the method mathematically aims to find the closest real solution point to that predicted point. So once you know this point, the goal of the algorithm is to find this point C sub S tilde, which is the closest point on the curve to this point. And that can be actually written down then as a minimization problem. So find the minimum distance between D and the curve over the points on the curve. And then it turns out you can take that minimization problem and implement an algorithm using essentially a Newton-Raphson type iterative solution procedure to solve that problem. And so what you do is you update your initial guess iteratively by doing a pseudo-inverse update. So you take the Jacobian, which of course is a non-square matrix, you compute the pseudo-inverse of that, and you treat it as if it's the inverse of the stiffness matrix, multiply it by the out-of-balance forces, and that gives you sort of a least squares best update solution to your equations, which you can then iterate on, and you can iteratively converge then to a solution on the curve. And this is pretty much guaranteed to converge under some relatively mild smoothness conditions and that sort of thing. However, you don't actually converge to the solution of the original minimization problem. You converge to an approximation to that solution. And the math, there are theorems that can show that the distance between the solution you converge to and the actual answer to the minimization problem that you set up initially is bound by this sort of order. So it's an order distance squared from between the prediction and the original point. So basically, given this prediction, you're guaranteed to converge to something that's order of this distance squared away from this point. And of course, we don't really care about what point we find so much on the curve, as long as we find a point on the curve. And so this technique, although it's more complicated than the Hacka technique, at least conceptually, can take advantage of a number of numerical advantages to be actually more a faster and more, in many cases, more robust numerical algorithm for finding points along these equilibrium curves. So we don't really care to find this point, we just want to find something near this point on the curve, and this theorem basically guarantees that we'll be able to do that. And one of the reasons that this has an advantage over the packet technique is that we can use the QR decomposition, which is a very fast decomposition of the matrix, of the Jacobian, to find both the tangent direction so that we can do our prediction, as well as to compute in a very efficient way the pseudo-inverse of the Jacobian. And so all all the pieces that go into this iterative solution technique are available once you have a QR decomposition of the Jacobian of this guy. That's fast, and so that makes this whole technique fast. And you avoid, you know, having to deal with this non-symmetric solve and all of these things. Right. Okay, so if we have that algorithm, then we have a way of really following any equilibrium path essentially as far as we like, as long as we're working with reduced equilibrium equations. So now we've said that, okay, we can extend the path beyond symmetry breaking bifurcation points by working with reduced equations. We can extend it past turning points by working with PADA or PACA. And so now, once we have a path, we can basically follow that as far as we like. Question? Yeah?
Could you explain again why it's cheaper to do this QR decomposition? What is small n? How large is this non-symmetric system in the first?
Yeah, so as I haven't thought about these details in depth recently. So
is this small n the same as capital N?
Yeah, it should be a capital N. So it's a question of doing a QR.
So but a Jacobian is also n times n.
N times n plus one.
Yeah.
And so it's a question of doing a QR or doing a non-symmetric inverse. And essentially have the inverse. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so maybe trying to think about the details here. Okay, so I think it's it's not quite such a big deal. As maybe I made it out to be. Let me just try to think where the other savings come in. So I think there are a number of things, and maybe they apply equally well to both. When I started learning these things, I learned this first, and then a few years later, I actually came across this PACA technique and was able to see that it was definitely going to be more efficient than with all the bells and whistles put together than the previous technique. But it's you may be right. Maybe possible to use the PACA technique. QR and maybe nearly as efficient as well. One thing that you do get that I would say that is an advantage is that by using this tangent that you get very nicely from here, in principle you should get a better approximation to a predictor. Because here you're really computing this the real tangent at this point. So hopefully that means you've got a better prediction. Whereas back in these sorts of cases, I always just used a delta vector between these, which is not necessarily aligned with the tangent of the actual curve. So there's lots of trade-offs here. And certainly this one is easier to implement in many ways than getting all the details right for the suitable inverse. So, okay, hopefully I've nominally answered your question. So we can follow these curves. Of course, there's bells and whistles you can put on top of this, so you can, once you're using a QR decomposition, you can do various updating schemes so that you don't have to recompute these things over and over again. And in the particular code that I've implemented in, I've put in a number of four different types of things, so there's you can do an update, so an exact update, so on every iteration you can recompute the Jacobian. Of course, that's maybe quite slow, but the most accurate. You can use Britain's update to, Britain's good update formula to update the Jacobian itself. That's a little better. Or you can get really clever, and somebody showed me that you can actually update the QR decomposition using a, something that's equivalent to the Britain's update as well, so that you don't even have to do the QR on every step. You can just update the QR decomposition in place. So this one is probably the one that we use the most. It's quite efficient and gives you decent updates, or of course you can just do no update at all and work with the Jacobian that you got from the initial prediction point and just iteratively use that, and hopefully your equilibrium equations are enough of a strong attractive map that will work. And often it does. So of course, as far as updates, this is the fastest thing, but often the improvement that you get by getting a better prediction of the Jacobian by doing this sort of update can often outperform this by reducing the number of iterations that you need to do. So that can be a significant improvement in speed for, in essence, as you say, both the techniques. And then another big deal is step size adaption. So of course, where the curve is changing very slowly, you don't need as many points. You can get away with a sort of linear or cubic spline between those solution points that are relatively far separated, and that would be a good approximation of the smooth continuous equilibrium curve. But where it's changing more rapidly, you need more points, and so you want to change your arc length parameter in those regions. And there's sort of some standard techniques for criteria that help you define when to decrease and when to increase your step size in the algorithm. And so these can be things like magnitude of the corrector step. So that would be like the first iteration here. How big is the first iteration? That's a measure of kind of how fast your map is contracting. The more contracting, the bigger the step you can probably take. The contraction rate, so what's the relative size of the displacement of the update that is going, and then you can even do sort of things like the angle between successive tangents. So if the tangent on your curve changes direction significantly between points, that may mean that it's changing very quickly, and you need to take smaller steps. Okay. So that's how you follow a single curve. So now the question is, how do we find bifurcation points and then follow bifurcated paths along as we're following a branch? Okay. So the question is, how is it as we're following a single branch we're going to find these special points, these bifurcation points? And so, of course, we recall those are the case where those critical points are the cases where the Hessian or the stiffness matrix of the full system of equations. So we're looking for symmetry breaking bifurcation points at this point. So the stiffness of the full system of equations has some zero eigenvalues. And so this is not the Jacobian because there's always one zero eigenvalue for the tangent, but the stiffness matrix. So with respect to only configuration variables. So that's got to be less than n, and that means that there's some number of zero eigenvalues. And those are the points that we're looking for. So at least one zero eigenvalue. And so the technique is to try to bracket those points and then use a numerical technique to refine and find the point within the brackets. So as a mathematical quantity, we've got the curve, and as we're following, determining points along the curve, we can detect a change in the sign of an eigenvalue between two successive points. And if we can do that, then we know that in between there, there's a crossing, a zero crossing of the eigenvalue. So at least one critical point exists between these two points on the curve if the product of the corresponding eigenvalues at those two points gives you a negative number. That means that the sign has changed. And so here the notation lambda sub k is the kth eigenvalue of this difference matrix. Okay, so the question then is, how do we actually evaluate this criterion numerically? There's a couple of problems that you can run across that you have to account for. One of the most challenging, in fact, is you need to be able to identify the kth eigenvalue as sort of a continuous function, smooth function of the arc length parameter. So of course there are theorems that will tell you for smooth systems that is true. You can write down the eigenvalues of the stiffness matrix as a smooth function of the path parameter. However, numerically you don't really have access to that function. You have access to the eigenvalues at certain points on the path. So schematically here, what I'm showing is the value of the various eigenvalues as a function of arc length along the path. And we imagine we have this sort of scenario where we've got one eigenvalue that's decreasing and crosses zero, and another eigenvalue that's increasing and crosses zero at a slightly different point on the curve. And so in principle then, mathematically, we have two bifurcation points here. We've got a bifurcation point here and a bifurcation point here. But numerically, what we have access to is the list of eigenvalues at various points along this curve. And really, these dots should probably line up at the same value of s. Sorry about that. So when you compute the stiffness at a given solution point, and you're going to be able to compute the eigenvalues at that point. And so that would be this black curve and a point on the gray curve. And the challenge is sort of ordering those eigenvalues so that you understand how they're changing as a function of the solution along the curve. And so this is what you would like. You'd like to be able to identify corresponding values on this curve and corresponding values on this curve. And the danger is that what you do is instead this. You identify this value, and then this value, this value, this value as the function lambda k, and then corresponding to this guy. And then you would never see your criterion, this calculation would show always the same sign and always the same sign, and you would miss an actual set of bifurcation points because of that misidentification of the eigenvalue functions. And so that's what we have to try to avoid in our numericals. And it's something of a challenge because typically you just have eigenvalue solvers for a given matrix, and there's no guarantee of sort of how the order in which eigenvalues get spit out basically by these algorithms. So if you've got a solution point here, you compute the eigenvalues in one iteration, in one calculation, you might get this one first and this one second. And if you perturb the numbers a little bit, maybe even just numerical precision, the calculation could spit out this value first and this value second, and that causes this sort of matching problem. So I can't say we've thought about this in real depth, but we've thought about it enough to give us a good heuristic that it seems to work reasonably well. And so here is the sort of heuristic that we use in our code to solve this sort of problem. We use basically a preconditioning of the stiffness matrix. So once we find a point and we find the eigenvalues, if we have our stiffness matrix, then we know eigenvalue solver basically gives us a change of coordinates that maps the stiffness matrix to a diagonal matrix, right? That's your similarity transformation that gives you the eigenvalues. And if you actually, instead of only computing eigenvalues, you also compute this transformation matrix, then you've got the eigenvectors of the system that transforms the stiffness to the diagonal elements. Okay. So now consider the case where you've got two successive points along a curve. Well, then there's going to be a transformation matrix for the first point and transformation for the second point that diagonalizes the corresponding stiffness matrices. Ri diagonalizes the stiffness matrix for point I, and Ri plus 1 diagonalizes the stiffness matrix for I plus 1. And assuming that there's enough smoothness and the eigenvalues are changing smoothly and not too quickly, and that S and Si and Si plus 1 are not too far apart, then it makes sense that the Ri plus 1 will be equal to Ri multiplied by another small similarity operation, another small rotation. And assuming that these things are relatively close, that there's some continuity in these sorts of functions, then this thing should be actually a rotation or a change of variables that is a rotation by a small angle. And so we try to take advantage of that fact and use the diagonalization transformation for point I as a preconditioner for point I plus 1. So if we do this sort of preconditioning, then as long as our step size is not too big, we expect this thing to be a nearly diagonal matrix with the main diagonals basically being the eigenvalues in the same order as which we got them up here for point I. And then if we apply a standard eigenvalue solver to that nearly diagonal matrix, most of them will simply apply this small rotation as opposed to switching the order of the eigenvalues, switching the order of the diagonals. And so that's what we try to take advantage of, is that we can precondition by this and then just use a standard eigenvalue solver. And in most cases, that will give us this sort of picture as opposed to this sort of picture. And you can put in some little diagnostics to try to identify when that might be failing.
Then you use a standard eigenvalue solver, which kind of solver do you use?
So the one that we have in the code at the moment, just because it's pretty simple and we're working with actually generally relatively small systems, so the system sizes that I've been working with typically have been on the order of 10 to 100 degrees of freedom. So we've been using a cyclic Jacobi algorithm to find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors. And that cyclic Jacobi seems to quite nicely, you know, apply this as opposed to to something else. To something like this times permutation is what you're trying to avoid. Yeah, good question.
Do you calculate the star of the matrices in each step, or do you
calculate which?
The Ri.
Yeah, so well, what you do is you compute Ri at the first point, right?
Yeah.
And then you at the next point, you do this preconditioning. You use cyclic Jacobi to find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of the preconditioning matrix. And then you can, from those eigenvectors, you can actually update the Ri. And so that you get Ri plus 1 in a relatively efficient way. Okay, so from this then, once this guarantees that we can identify eigenvalue crossings, so that we've now isolated our bifurcation point, our zero of this sort of function, between two solution points. And now basically what we're going to do is essentially numerical equation solving to solve for this actual point. And we'll basically do that with a one-dimensional equation solving algorithm where we work with arc length basically as the free variable. And so that brings up a bit of an issue. So we've got this arc length solution procedure where we've got ds that we can change the step length along the curve, and we want to change ds and basically do bisection or something similar using this bracket that we found to identify the bifurcation point. So suppose there's a bifurcation point here, and we've bracketed it between CI, here and here. Then we can, by bisecting on delta S, we should be able to find that bifurcation. However, when we switched over to this pseudo-arc length tangent method, when we started using that technique, we realized, oh, that's not going to work for us in this bisection technique because of the nature of that technique. So in fact, remember, we were guaranteed to find a point that was close to the ideal point. But it doesn't say that the algorithm and the math don't tell us anything about exactly where in that range of points we're going to get the solution. And so even though we might choose various values of delta S to try to bisect on that, we could get ourselves in a situation using PATA, wherever it is, yeah, the tangent approximation solution, where we're just bouncing around and we're unable to accurately do a bisection technique to find the bifurcation point. And so to actually do this, then we switch back to the constraint approach, where we do have a guarantee that by changing delta S, at least locally here, we can very systematically access all points along this curve and know that if we increase delta S, we get a point that's further along the curve, or if we decrease delta S, we get a point closer to the curve. So we switch over to using PACA so that we can bisect and basically treat this curve as a function locally of the arc length parameter delta S in that algorithm. And then you simply apply your standard techniques to find the solution of a single equation in one unknown. And you can use bisection. Of course, that will be quite robust, but asymptotically, n log n or n log log n sort of solution. And so, what we typically do then is use Brent's method on that technique, which often provides a reduction in the number of iterations that you need to accurately find the bifurcation. Typically some sort of superlinear convergence instead of the logarithmic convergence of bisection. Does that make sense? Okay, so then that means that we can now, as we're following one of these, and actually I guess I should make the point so let me come back to here. So we've got these eigenvalues, and we're looking for this point here where eigenvalue becomes zero. And remember, it's an eigenvalue of the stiffness matrix of the equilibrium equations. And in order to find any point on this curve, we're having to do a Newton-Raphson type of iteration to find all of the degrees of freedom for that point. And so if you're working with the full set of equations, then these eigenvalues are eigenvalues of the Jacobian or the Hessian or the stiffness matrix that you're using in your Newton-Raphson equations. And so you're running into a very bad scenario where you're looking for a point where that stiffness matrix is singular. And that's exactly a point where your Newton-Raphson scheme is going to behave very poorly because the equations you're solving become ill-conditioned. And so if that were the end of the story, we'd be in real trouble. We'd never be able to bracket and really find the bifurcation point to a high level of accuracy, numerical accuracy, because we would run into this problem of ill conditioning and the Newton-Raphson scheme would not converge very well. And so you'd be left with only finding this point within a relatively large, fuzzy numerical precision. However, because these are symmetry breaking bifurcation points, you can take advantage of the symmetry reduction. And so for the Newton-Raphson stuff, you can compute along this curve, you can always be using the reduced set of equations, which, as you may recall, we discussed briefly that with the reduced set of equations, the symmetry breaking bifurcation points are not critical points in those set of equations. another way of saying that is that the symmetry reduction throws out the part of the stiffness matrix, right? It reduces the size of the system. And it's exactly throwing out the part of the stiffness matrix which corresponds to this eigenvalue, which is going to zero. So you're guaranteed that if you've got this sort of symmetry gradient bifurcation point, this eigenvalue, this eigenvector, is removed by the symmetry reduction, so that the Newton-Raphson scheme on the reduced set of equations does not see this singularity, and therefore is nicely regular and will converge nicely for any point along this curve. And so you're actually able to compute the configuration of this bifurcation point to machine precision in most cases. So again, that's another very important application of these symmetry techniques. All right. Okay, so we can find bifurcation points. So now the question is, once we've found a bifurcation point, how do we identify the bifurcating paths that cross through that point? And the approach that we'll take here is that we want to be able to asymptotically, so in the neighborhood of the bifurcation point, characterize the bifurcating paths that come out of that path from the path that we've been following, so what I would call a principal path. So we've been following this point, we've done a bisection technique to find the bifurcation point, or over here in this case, we've been following this curve, and we did bisection, we find this point. So now how do we find these curves? And what we're going to do is create a system of equations which will, in the neighborhood of this bifurcation point, characterize these bifurcating paths so that we can have a way to predict a point on this curve slightly off the previous curve. And then once we can do that, that means we can seed one of our path following algorithms with a prediction which will be close to the bifurcated path. And then we hope that the path following algorithm can pick that curve up and follow it away from the bifurcation. And this actually works quite well in practice. So what we need then is an asymptotic analysis that allows us to characterize all the bifurcated paths that emerge from a bifurcation point. And of course, it'll be a symmetry breaking bifurcation point. What does that mean? It means that we're going to do some asymptotic mathematical analysis to identify the initial tangent to these points, so the components of these AIs, which is the increment in the x direction, the I direction, and the increment in lambda, so that we get an initial tangent of this curve, or in the case where we have a symmetric bifurcation, the initial increment asymptotically of this curve is zero in this direction, so you need actually a curvature, so you need a higher order asymptotic expression for symmetric points. So we want to be able to compute these coefficients alpha I and lambda 1 or lambda. Okay, so I'm going to go relatively quickly through the details of how you do this asymptotic analysis, hopefully to give you a flavor of what's going on, but I think it'll be too much for 4 o'clock on a Friday, or on a whatever, Wednesday. When Tuesday. Okay, I'm going to wait for too long. On a Tuesday afternoon, and any afternoon, let's say. At least after 3 hours. So it turns out that all you really need to know about a bifurcation point is what's happening in the subspace of configuration space that has become unstable. So if you've seen maybe anything about in dynamical systems, you might have seen center manifold theory. The same sort of thing is true in static problems, where what you need to look at is what's really driving the overall dynamics or the overall equilibrium behavior is those degrees of freedom which are soft or have essentially zero stiffness. So it makes a lot of sense to split out your degrees of freedom into those that are basically singular or have zero eigenvalue and those that have positive stiffness or non-zero stiffness. and work with a set of degrees of freedom that are identified in that way. So, okay, great. So back here, at this sort of symmetry rate of bifurcation point, often there are multiple eigenvalues that go to zero at the same time because of the symmetry. So instead of just one zero eigenvalue, you get two or three or five or six. And so the number of zero eigenvalues h is often greater than one. And that makes things very complicated. In fact, instead of there being only one bifurcating path, you can have essentially any number of paths crossing at exactly the same point. And that's where this sort of analysis becomes a challenge. So what we'll do, so the, yeah, I guess I didn't define it here. The null space, or that space of zero eigenvectors, we'll call capital N here. And it's useful then to split your degrees of freedom, your configuration space, into those that are in the null space, those components in the null space, and those in the orthogonal complement. So you split your configuration space into a subspace that's spanned by the null space of the stiffness at the bifurcation point and everything else. So you've got your sort of instability modes, which are in the null space, and your modes that are stable that are in the orthogonal complement. So that's defined here. So the space that maps to zero under the stiffness and everything else. So then you can decompose your configuration into the bifurcation point plus a deviation from the bifurcation point associated with the unstable modes or the null space plus a deviation associated with all the rest of the degrees. And to do this, you can actually construct a projection operator using the eigenvectors of this space. So this sort of tensor product space will give you a projection operator such that you can take any given configuration variable, apply the projection operator, and you get the components in C. And similarly, you can take the complement to that operator and get the values of V. So these are projections into the null space and the orthogonal complement space. And then what you actually do is split your equilibrium equations along those same spaces. So you write your equilibrium equations as components in the null space and the orthogonal complement space. But then you project those into the two spaces. So you project the out-of-balance forces, let's say, into the null space and into the orthogonal complement. So you split your set of your equations into two pieces, one that's in the null space and one that's in the orthogonal complement space. And then what you do is you take this system, so this is the one that's in the orthogonal complement space, that's basically in a space that is stable. So there are no zero eigenvalues near the bifurcation point. And you think in terms of holding these degrees of freedom fixed, so the unstable degrees of freedom fixed. And then what you can do is actually show that these equations that then become a set of equations for the degrees of freedom V as a function of lambda and these guys, the C values. And it turns out that if you expand those equations, so you do an asymptotic expansion of those equations, the leading order terms are regular because we got rid of all the zero eigenvalues by this particular projection. So basically, this part and the definition of this guarantees that this set of equations, the Hessian, let's say, the Jacobian of that set of equations is regular. And so you can actually solve that set of equations for these guys. So you can do an asymptotic expansion and get an asymptotic expression for these guys as a function of these degrees of freedom and lambda. And then what you do is you take that expression and plug it back into these equations. So you substitute here, and then what you're left with is a small set of equations, which is of size h, the number of zero eigenvalues. Usually, like I say, that's one, two, or three, whereas this n might be 1,000, or it might be infinite. In fact, this is true in continuous systems. So this could be a really large number, but the size, the dimension of this space is going to be small, 1, 2, 3, 6, something like that. And this process then eliminates, you know, all the rest of the equations, and all you're left with are these equations, which are a system of 1, 2, or 3 equations. So you get this. This is what's called the Lyapunov-Schmidt decomposition, or Lyapunov-Schmidt Coyter decomposition. So you reduce a very large system of equations down to a very small system of equations. Then all you need to do then is solve for the c as a function of lambda, and you'll find your solution paths. So doing that is exactly this. You can define what are known as the bifurcation equations for a given problem, which are a set of a small set of equations in terms of these unstable degrees of freedom and a deviation from of the loading parameter, and it's given by this expression. And then what you can do is now expand this problem. So there's, if you work through the details of this sort of thing, there's just an immense amount of Taylor expansion. So you sit down, you get a table full of paper, and you start Taylor expanding, and you keep track of all the terms, and you plug things in, and it's not very hard, it's tedious. But if you go through all those steps, you expand these equations, you now expand the degrees of freedom that you're left with. So this is your representation of a curve of an equilibrium path that's bifurcating from the bifurcation point. You expand that in terms of a scalar bifurcation amplitude parameter, which you can think of as kind of arc length along the curve. So you expand those, you plug it into the bifurcation equations, you expand the bifurcation equations, then you'll get eventually down to an asymptote or an algebraic set of equations that you can solve for these initial tangents of the bifurcated path. The details are tough. In the asymmetric case, in a case where the bifurcated path looks like this, you only need leading order terms in the expansion of the load parameter, and you've got your principal path plus linear terms in the bifurcation amplitude, degrees of freedom. And when you do the expansion and keep the leading order terms, you end up with this set of equations, which has these alpha coefficients. So those are the tangents to the bifurcated path. Here's the lambda, that's the lambda tangent part. And then what's left are these coefficients, epsilon ijk and epsilon ij lambda. And so this, along with the normalization condition on the tangent, gives you a set of equations that you can, for which each solution of that set of equations basically corresponds to a bifurcated path. And these coefficients are nicely defined as simply higher order derivatives of your original energy function evaluated at the bifurcation point and contracted with the bifurcation directions, the eigenvalues that are associated with the zero eigenvalues. So it's nice in some sense. This is a nice analysis because all you need to be able to do is evaluate your function and its derivatives at a single point at the bifurcation point. And you're able to construct, at least in the neighborhood of that point, all of the equilibrium solution paths. Okay, so if you can do those computations for the asymmetric case, you've got this. And so this is basically a second order system of equations in the unknowns alpha. So it's a second order polynomial system of equations. And as long as h is relatively small, that's the number of equations, you can probably solve that. If you've got an unsymmetric bifurcated path, then you actually have to include, not unsymmetric. If you've got a symmetric path, then that actually just means that your loading parameter, the initial term, the leading order term there is zero, so this term drops out, and you have to include the next order term in this expansion, and that actually ends up requiring you to add second order terms in the configuration expansion as well. When you go through the process in that case, you end up with the leading order terms in the final expansion being cubic in those curvature parameters. And you've got the lambda 2 coming in here. Right, now you need a new set of coefficients, epsilon I, j, k, l, and so that's related to the fourth order derivative of your energy through this sort of expression. There's a detail about actually calculating these V terms, which are defined here, because you've got the stiffness matrix of the system at the bifurcation point. That stiffness matrix is singular, so solving the system of equations requires you to be a bit careful. I won't bother with that. So the basic final answer here is that by going through all of this process, you can numerically compute this sort of equation by numerically evaluating these coefficients. And then that gives you all the information you need to solve for these bifurcated tangents. So ultimately you end up with these sorts of equations. You can compute numerically these coefficients, and then you just need solutions to those equations. Generically, in the asymmetric case, you're going to have this many pair of solutions. So if there are two zero eigenvalues, then you've got 4 minus 1, you've got 3 pairs of solutions, which indicates that you've got 3 bifurcated paths that come out of that sort of solution. And similarly, in the symmetric case, you get another set of solutions. So the idea is, at least what I've done in the code that I use, is to numerically compute these sort of things, and then sort of, at this point by hand, find the solutions to these things, use that information to seed a new path-following technique to follow the bifurcated paths. So that's how you can identify and path-follow these bifurcated solutions. One of the nice things that you can get, in addition to just being able to find those bifurcated paths from this sort of analysis, is that you can do a non-trivial check on the code that you've actually written for your energy function to see that you've implemented it consistently. So what do I mean by that? So here's an example. So say I numerically computed this path, and then I numerically computed two bifurcated paths from that. And so those numerical computations are the triangles and the squares here. Well, then I've gone and numerically done this asymptotic analysis using information only at this point of the energy. And I've obtained an asymptotic expression for these bifurcated paths. And so that's the dashed line. And so I can compare that asymptotic expression to the numerical solution. And I better have that those things match up, at least in a neighborhood of this bifurcation point. So if, for instance, I can compare the curvature, the asymptotic curvature of this solution, to the curvature that I get from the numerical solution and see that things match up. If they don't match up, that means that probably somewhere there's a bug in my energy and its derivatives calculation. So in fact, I spent 3 months during my PhD trying to find exactly one of those sorts of bugs because I had this check. Things wouldn't match up, and that meant there was a bug somewhere. And so I had to track it down. But those sorts of things I think are important when you do numerics, is finding as many possible ways to ensure that you've got self-consistency in your code. All right. So after a couple hours here, we've walked through many of the details of exactly how you can do one of these sorts of calculations. And for the rest of my time, there is officially an hour left. Hopefully, maybe I won't take all of that time. Let's say, let me take 20 minutes to show you how I've used these techniques to explore a scientific problem. I know I can do this in 20 minutes. I've given this talk, this part of the talk. So I'm going to be interested in shape memory alloys. You may remember these pictures from the beginning of the afternoon. So shape memory alloys are materials that at high temperatures, they're crystal structures. Let me actually go here. The atoms arrange in a high symmetry crystal structure. Often it's a cubic crystal structure, something like a B2 cesium chloride type of crystal structure, which is a sort of BCC type structure where the atoms on the corners of a unit cell are of one type, maybe nickel. And and the atom in the center of the cell is a different type, so maybe it's titanium. So you've got a 50-50 mixture of nickel and titanium, and it turns out that that's ship number an alloy in many cases. So at high temperatures, the atoms arrange like this. At low temperatures, there's an instability, and the atoms take up a different phase, a different crystal structure, which has lower symmetry. And often it's tetragonal, orthorhombic, or a monoclinic type symmetry. And these are some of the actual crystal structures that are seen in real materials. So a real austenite phase, the high temperature phase, high symmetry phase, is often this B2 crystal structure like this. And the low temperature, or in other terms, martensitic phase, is often one of these types of crystal structures. So these names are kind of arbitrary. There's something called an L10 structure, which has tetragonal symmetry. There's a B19 structure, which is orthorhombic. There's a B19 prime, which is a monoclinic distortion of this guy. And don't worry about that. Of course, now, if you look at these unit cells, you say, well, how do you get there from this? And so it's useful to understand how you can do relatively simple deformations of this crystal to get to this. Of course, you have to remember that this thing is repeated periodically throughout space, so that it fills space in a perfect lattice crystal structure. So you take this thing, shift it over by this much, and repeat it over and over in both directions, same thing in this direction, same thing in this direction. So you've got this infinite structure, and this is just a representation of that infinite structure. Same thing for these guys. Here, these are periodically repeated by shifting this much, this much, this much. Okay, but it's not easy to see how you get from here to here, so the easiest way to do that is to imagine actually a 2x2 set of cells of this guy. So that's sort of these gray lines here. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 of these unit cells. And then what you need to do is actually consider this larger unit cell, which is actually at a different orientation. So that's this cell. And if you draw that cell and identify these atoms, and you take this thing and now you turn him on his end and stand it up, you get this thing. And so believe it or not, when you periodically extend this cell, just like you periodically extend this cell, you get exactly the same structure. There's really no difference. So it's just a different way of numbering or labeling or naming this structure. So this thing is exactly the same as this thing. And now, when you see this thing, it's easier to understand how you get to these other crystal structures. So if you take this cell, of course, the periodic extended thing, and you just simply uniformly deform this so that this side length, in this case, this side length and this side length are equal in the cubic case. If you now make this length different from this length, then you get this tetragonal structure. If you allow, actually, there to be no relationship between these three side lengths, so this length can be independently set with respect to this one and this one, so that there are three values there, then you get this orthorhombic structure, except that you have to have what are known as internal shifts. So the atoms, which are originally at the very face center here, they're at the halfway point along this line, and these guys, which are at the halfway point along this, these guys actually shift to the left or to the right. And so you can see in this crystal structure, instead of being at the center, these atoms have moved relative to the cell edges, let's say, to the left. And that turns out to be important in the physics of this sort of problem. Not only do you change the spacing of the unit cell, the translational parameters, unit cell parameters, but you also move the atoms around inside the cell. And that turns out to be an important. And then to get to here, you actually just do a uniform shear. As you can see the gray lines here. You just shear this so that it takes up this angle, and this angle here is no longer 90, then you get a monoclinic structure. So from a high-level sort of material science level description of this phase transition, you say that at high temperatures, the material is in this austenite phase that's observed to that crystal structure. At low temperatures, the material, say, takes up, for instance, this crystal structure. And that's what's just observed as the physics of this phase transition. And now I want to try to model and explain maybe why that sort of transition occurs and why maybe this particular crystal structure shows up, or this one, when you start from this structure. Okay, but back to general description of the material behavior. What are shaken ring alloys? So there are these materials that at high temperature you have this one, the austenite structure, at low temperature, the martensite structure. And as I said earlier, when this transition occurs, in order that the material doesn't rip itself into pieces, the martensite forms these very complex microstructures that are show up on micrographs in these sort of needle-like patterns. And it turns out that actually that process of creating these microstructures and the fact that you can deform these microstructures in a very particular way at the macroscopic scale, so now you step back and start looking at wires made out of this material or sheets of the material. The macroscopic behavior is very unique as far as the behavior of metals. So most metals, like steels, can only deform to small strain, maybe a tenth of a percent of strain, or 1% strain is a large strain in metals. Shaken ring alloys, because of this underlying micromechanics and nanomechanics, can be exposed to strains on the order of 10% and actually fully recover their original configuration. And that's where this shape memory idea comes in. So here I've got a macroscopic depiction of the behavior of shape memory materials. So this is an actual experiment that was done on a shape memory alloy wire, thin wire. You pull it in the uniaxial extension compression. You control the temperature of the wire, and you can see different behavior. So at low temperatures, so here's temperature, here's strain, nominal strain, and here's nominal force or stress that's required to stretch the wire. So at low temperatures, we get this curve. And it behaves like a highly nonlinear material, maybe even a plastic material. You load it up, initially it has some sort of linear behavior, then it goes into a very nonlinear, what looks like plastic yield. And eventually it actually stiffens up a bit, but it's still sort of yielding. And if you release the load, actually it comes back, and there's a residual strain, in this case out to about 5%. So that looks like typical plasticity that you might see in a standard dog bone steel specimen, although that would be an awful large strain that you would need steel to strain out to. The really amazing thing about these materials is that if you simply heat them up, so now we were holding at essentially zero stress or zero force, and just increasing the temperature. You heat it up for a long time, basically nothing happens. So now think of temperature as your loading parameter. You heat it up, basically nothing's happening. And then at some critical value of load or temperature, the phase transition kicks in. The material wants to transform from this martensitic phase to this high symmetry austenite phase. That means that there's no longer the possibility of this complex microstructure. And that actually causes the macroscopic system to recover its original shape. So that residual strain is erased. And the material is able to go back to essentially a zero strain system. If you cooled it down now, you'd actually get exactly the same sort of thing. And you can actually heat this up and cycle it, and so you get, that's where the name shape memory comes in. You can, at low temperatures, you can apparently permanently deform the system. So you've got a wire, you can wrap it around your finger, and it stays spiraled up. But then if you drop it in a hot glass of water, transition occurs, and it goes right back to a straight, perfect configuration. You can do this over and over again. Really cool materials. And then if you go up to higher temperatures, you can get something that's called pseudoelasticity, where you can go out to really large strains, 8 to 10% strain, amazing amount of strain in a metal. And upon removal of the load, so as soon as you let go, it goes right back to the original configuration with zero strain. And you see something that looks elastic. But in fact, there's a dissipation of energy in the system because it's the stress strain curve is actually, there's a hysteresis loop here. And so it's not quite elastic because there is a path dependence and there's hysteresis, but it's pseudo-elastic because it's always, once you release all the load, you return to the original configuration. So these are really cool materials. There's interest in using these as energy dissipators, as actuators, as sensors for sensing critical temperature changes, that sort of thing. My interest is understanding exactly why these phase transitions occur by doing atomic scale modeling. Okay. And that's why I was telling you about the crystal structure. So I'm going to create an atomic model that describes interactions between atoms, and then explore that model using branch modeling and bifurcation techniques in order to try to find a prediction of a temperature-induced transformation like this that corresponds to the physics that we see in real materials. Okay. So I'll take 5 minutes and explain the model that I've set up. So I'm simply going to use very simple atomistic model, which is just pair interactions. So in a two-species alloy like this, there are three different types of pairs of atoms that you can create. If you say the blue atoms here are, let's call those A atoms, and the red atoms, we call them B atoms, then there's a AA interaction, so this blue interaction, there's a BB interaction, and then there's an AB interaction. And so if I want to describe the energy of atomic interactions in terms of pairs, I need to describe three energy functions that describe the energy as a function of distance between the two atoms. And so I'm going to define temperature-dependent interactions. So theta will be my normalized temperature in some sense. R is the distance between two atoms. And I'm going to describe the energy at a given temperature and a given separation distance through this exponential form, which is known as a Morse pair potential. And the only thing that makes it temperature dependent is that this parameter R hat is a function of temperature. And so this sort of functional form looks something like this. So energy is a function of separation distance. And so you see there's a minimum energy configuration for each pair, and each type of pair has a different location for that energy minimum, and actually that's what this R hat is. It's the location of the minimum of the potential. And so by making that temperature dependent, then this location can change, and if they change, if the location changes in a non-uniform way for each of these three bonds, that can drive that can make a driving force for a change in the crystal structure of the material. So for instance, at low temperature, we have this sort of energy where the equilibrium spacing of all three types of bonds is relatively close. And at higher temperature, it is 2, the equilibrium spacing is spread out, and that means that maybe a crystal structure where the blue atoms are closer together would be more favorable than one where all the atoms are about equally spaced.
Why is minimum of the potential changes with temperature?
So this is where I put phenomenology in at this level. And I'm going to give you a very hand-wavy sort of phenomenological type of idea for why you might have this sort of thing. So you can think of, say simply, the fact that there is thermal expansion. So you can think of this as, in some sense, as thermal expansion of the bonds. So the bonds, let's say that this is the sort of bonding we have at a low level of temperature. So there's some equilibrium spacing that we expect to see at that temperature. And as we increase the temperature, we expect there to be thermal expansion, and so we would expect the bond lengths to naturally increase. So that's maybe, I hope that's a very simplistic motivation for why we might want these things to change the temperature. So by doing this sort of thing without doing dynamics, like molecular dynamics or something like that, you can capture some thermal effects. So again, I need an energy, and I'm interested in static equilibrium configurations to use my fractional bifurcation philosophy. And so I'm not going to do molecular dynamics or anything here. I'm going to do molecular statics. but with an effective temperature. Okay, and I choose just some. This is basically quadratic variation of the spacing with temperature. Okay, so that's in some sense a constitutive law for the atomistics. But now I don't want to consider all possible atomic configurations. I want to consider only crystalline structures, perfect crystals. And so I have to choose a kinematics that describes what sort of crystalline configurations I'm going to consider. And I do that with what is known as Cauchy-Mort kinematics. And probably for this group, all I want to say here is that this basically describes the size and shape of the unit cell, so that this length and this length and this length and the angles that these three corners make. So you can get a full description of the shape of the unit cell, the size and shape. That information is carried by this uniform deformation term here, which is a symmetric 3x3 matrix. So that you've got 6 degrees of freedom there to describe the 6 lattice parameters, let's say. Three side lengths and 3 angles. But then I told you that there's going to be important physics associated with the location of the atoms inside the unit cell. And so you have to add some of these degrees of freedom into the kinematics as well. So you not only describe the shape of the unit cell and its size, but where the atoms are inside the unit cell. And so those will be the internal atomic shift variables. And so that's a vector, in essence, for each atom in the cell. And so here in this model, we've got 4 atoms per cell. Okay, we have to throw out rigid body translations. So let's think of it as sort of 3 atoms per cell. Or in other words, one of these shift vectors is 0. So then we've got 3 vectors, so 3 three-dimensional vectors. So that's 9 degrees of freedom, in addition to the 6 that describe the size and shape of the cell. So given some reference configuration, which we take as the austenite structure, so we take this B2 as a reference configuration, the position of an atom alpha in unit cell L, so that describes all of the atoms, is given by this quantity. And then we're going to consider all deformed crystals that you can get by allowing the atoms to move around within the unit cell however they like through these degrees of freedom. And then you deform the unit cell overall through a strain-like quantity, or you change the lattice parameters. And that gives you a deformed configuration, which we can consider. Okay. Constitutive laws. If you're a continuum mechanics person, we've got a constitutive law, we've got a set of kinematics. We can combine those two things to get a sort of an effective or a structural theory in some sense. Energy in terms of those kinematical degrees of freedom by taking these interatomic potentials and adding up all the interactions, the interaction between this atom and this atom, and those two, and this one, and the atom over here in the next cell. We add up all of that information in the appropriate way, and we get something that looks like kind of a strain energy density that depends on these kinematics and the temperature. Maybe this is the free energy function of this material. And now I have my energy as a set of finite degrees of freedom and a loading parameter, temperature. And so now I can turn the crank on everything we've talked about today. So I have all the physics is here. Now I want to see what does this particular model that's completely described right here, what sort of predictions does it make? If it's highly nonlinear, there's nonlinear geometry going on here, nonlinear energy functions. There are probably literally thousands of equilibrium configurations for each value of temperature. How can we figure out what this model predicts? This is where I think the power of this bifurcation technique comes in. So let's remind us of the problem we want to solve. We want to find equilibrium solutions, so that's derivatives of the energy with respect to the kinematics equal to 0. In this particular model, that comes out to be 15 nonlinear algebraic equations for 15 unknowns for every given temperature. Pretty small, easy system to solve, right? 15 degrees of freedom. Nonlinearity can make it pretty hard. But of course, equilibrium is not enough. We want to know about stability as well. And basically, we have local energy minimization. going to skip some extra details about other types of energy stability considerations. So turn the crank. This is the sort of answer that I get. A rather more complicated bifurcation diagram that I've shown you previously. Let me spell all this out for you. So this is a measure of the energy of the system. So it's the energy of an equilibrium configuration normalized by an elastic constant, so that you get non-dimensional quantities. This is our non-dimensional temperature normalized at a reference temperature of 1, which is considered kind of high temperature, so it should be the oscillating phase for this material. Okay, again, this curve, this set of plots, so this is again temperature. Yeah, okay, now I'm going to confuse you. Here, this is a kinematic measure. So this is, lambda is no longer the load, it's actually a kinematic measure, it's a particular projection, basically, in this parameter space. What it really is it's the amount of stretch that the unit cell undergoes in some direction, and it's the direction which has the largest amount of stretch. So it's the maximum stretch out of all directions. If you're a continuum mechanics person, it's the maximum principal stretch for the strain that's associated. So lambda max. So in some sense, it's the maximum amount of strain you're getting from the equilibrium configuration at that temperature. Okay, so let me give you the rundown. So how did we compute this? Well, we started at some, say, reference temperature. We used our path following algorithms. We followed for high temperatures, and we saw that this cubic structure, B2 cubic, was stable in equilibrium and stable for high temperatures. So then, and basically stable for as high a temperature as you want to go. If we now decrease the temperature, we follow the path, it goes along, eventually it reaches a bifurcation point, so here's a zoom in at this point, it reaches a bifurcation point, and it's unstable below that. But in fact, we see a couple of bifurcation points along that line. So this bifurcation point actually has two zero eigenvalues that go simultaneously due to symmetry. So we do the asymptotic analysis, the LSK, we solve those equations, identify the initial tangents of the bifurcating paths. It turns out two, that means they're symmetric, so there are six bifurcating paths that emerge from that point. Those split into two groups of three. Each of the groups is symmetry related, so it's just a rigid body rotation. So I've only plotted two of the equilibrium paths. So only these two are two representatives of the energetically distinct bifurcated solutions. So those paths come out, they're initially unstable. They turn out to be actually of this B19 crystal structure and something called an alpha IRV crystal structure. Path follow those along. They're initially stable, but eventually they reach turning points in lambda. And after those turning points, they're stable here. And actually, this B19 is unstable after the turning point, but stabilizes after a secondary bifurcation point. So it's stable. So we found a couple of stable structures. We found other bifurcation points. We're able to follow the bifurcated paths from those. There's a bifurcation point here along the principal path. That's again, a two-dimensional bifurcation point, so another six, actually in this case, only three bifurcated paths come out. They're all symmetry-related, so that's this blue path that's initially unstable, that stabilizes for low temperatures, and in fact, this path turns out to reconnect to that bifurcation point here. You can follow lots of other bifurcated curves and bifurcated paths, but it turns out that those are the only stable ones that we find in this. Analysis. So by mapping all of this stuff out, we've actually discovered four different stable structures for this model. The B2, which we kind of knew ahead of time, we basically constructed the model to make sure that austenite structure was stable at high temperature. But we had really no idea that these other things existed or were stable. And by following these paths, we discovered these phases that are predicted by the model. And we found out that they're actually predicted to be stable. If we look at the energy, We see that at high temperatures, we've got the oscillating phase. At lower temperatures, the minimum energy structure, which is what we would expect to see from thermodynamics, would be the, so at intermediate temperatures would be this orthorhombic alpha IRV phase. And at even lower temperatures still, there's sort of a competition between this L10 and the B19 crystal structure. And at the lowest values, it turns out that the B19 structure is always the global energy minimum. And so the punchline here then is that this model, without these things being put in, was at the beginning by constructing them, was able to create to predict the existence of these four different stable crystal structures as far as temperature-induced transitions. At high temperatures, as you lower the temperature, you would be expected to transition from B2 to alpha RV to B19. And so you get this prediction of a sequence of temperature-induced transitions from this model. That's good. That's qualitatively like we see in shape memory alloys, the fact that you have a change of phases as you increase or decrease the temperature. But even better than that, actually, from this model, was that it was able to predict many of the common crystal structures that are really seen in the physical world. So we built in B2, but we didn't do anything else to make sure that this happened. And the physics, the symmetry that's built into this model, naturally then predicted the existence of the B19 structure, as well as the L10 structure as being interesting structures. And in fact, that's, as I told you before, the sort of things that experimentalists have observed in the real structures. And so we take that as a success of the model that it was able to predict not only the existence of a transition, but the right sorts of crystal structures that are actually seen in the materials. And so so that was quite a positive thing for us. And I think, you know, without these branch following bifurcation techniques, we'd have a very difficult time figuring out this sort of picture of an understanding of what this model actually predicts. So I think I'm pretty much done. I'm going to go through three slides in very quick succession. You can extend this sort of thing and study what happens when you apply stress and look at stress-induced transformations, which are important in shape memory alloys. So you can add a stress, you can do a new bifurcation analysis at high temperature. There, things get a lot more complicated because we're breaking more and more symmetries. So there's hundreds of bifurcation points, thousands of bifurcated paths. We followed some subset of these things. It took me about 3 years to do this one. We've now automated this process that we can do it a little bit better. You find a lot of new possible equilibrium structures. So there's 6 or 8 different distinct crystal structures that come out under applied loads. You can say, well, which one of these do you expect to be a reversible transition so that when you remove the load, you go back to the B2 structure? Well, there's a criterion for that, and it points out that only one of these structures is realistic for the stress-induced transformation. And if you look at the behavior of this transformation, stress versus strain, and stress versus strain is a function of temperature, as temperature is increased, we see all the same qualitative trends that you see in the real materials. So the system gets stiffer, the transition occurs at higher levels of load, as you increase the temperature, that's the sort of thing you see in experiments. And that's my final slide. So I hope I've given you some flavor of the merits that go into these sorts of calculations and the sorts of scientific problems that you may be able to apply them to. So with that, I think I will finish up. And thank you for your attention. And I'll be happy to have discussions and answer questions pretty much whenever you can find me while I'm here throughout the rest of the week.